Here we are, State Wars Hockey Podcast number 25. I'm Tim McManus here with Greg Thompson, Long Island, New York. How's it going today, Greg?
What's going on, Tim? Nothing much here. You know, little playback. No, just hanging out here. I actually just listened to Spit and Chicken's podcast, just gearing up for today's episode. And no, just kind of hanging out here, getting ready. Still getting ready for this baby, Tim. Got a sonogram later today, so should be any day. We'll see.
Well, like I said, enjoy the peace and quiet now, because your life's in for a big change, my friend. But all for the better, for sure. So yeah, we're all excited for GT on his fatherhood here, coming really soon. Taking bets on boy or girl here, Greg. So what are you thinking?
I'm thinking girl.
Now, are you saying that reverse psychology because you really want a boy? And you think if you keep saying girl, it's going to be a boy? Is that what you're kind of doing here? Or are you really thinking girl?
No, I mean, I think the baby's heart rate is pretty high. So, I mean, there's been a myth that it's, you know, girls usually have higher heart rates. And also, you know, Amy's friend is having a girl as well. And like just them standing side by side with one another, just, you know, they kind of look similar. So for me, I'm thinking girl. So,
well, I will tell you, as someone, as you know, who has three daughters, that none of that means shit. you know,
that's what I hear.
My wife looked different all three pregnancies, and the heart rate was different, how she carried was different, what she was hungry for was different, everything, and we had the girl every time. So it's still a coin flip, 50-50. And at the end of the day, as long as it's healthy, that's all that matters.
Yeah, 100% right. I know you guys had a confirmation last night, correct?
Yeah, it was my oldest daughter, Sydney's confirmation. So that was pretty crazy, getting older here. Yeah. You know, it was, you know, part of this pandemic thing here. It's a little different where, you know, it's, you know, four people or five people were allowed per family at the church, and everyone's wearing masks and whatnot. But it was a nice little ceremony, quick 45 minutes, and we got done with it. So it was nice, though, and obviously great to have the family there. My parents were there, and my kids and everybody, the siblings. So it was nice.
It's crazy to think about. You know, Sydney was born when, 2007?
Six.
So I still remember that one picture from, you know, her first year coming to State Wars.
In Cincinnati?
Cincinnati, yeah. And it's just time flies, man.
I have it on my desk somewhere. I don't know where I even put it. It's always right on my desk. As you know, my desk is always a mess. Things got thrown on top of it. So maybe I'll find it by the end. But yeah, no, long time. You know, first year of State Wars, I had no kids. So lots changed in the 16 years we've been doing this. So, but like you said, all great stuff.
Less grayer too.
What's that?
You said you were less grayer too.
Yeah, I didn't have this gray on the side of my hair, that's for sure, back then. but yeah, no, all good stuff here. I don't know, every time I look back at my Facebook page, I feel like the page is frozen. So hopefully everything's going okay on the other end there with everybody seeing stuff. So, but yeah, no, we got a great episode today, Greg. You know, we have a longtime friend of ours, Pete Penicky, who's an NHL events coordinator, who was in the bubble for 72 days, just got back yesterday or the day before. So he's coming on for a little bit. We're going to talk a little about life inside the bubble, which is pretty awesome. You know, Pete, I've been coaching Pete since 1996. He was our goalie for many years with the Snipers, and you joined on with the Snipers. He was our goalie, was an excellent goalie back in his day, won many NARCH championships, junior, D1 with him. He got involved with pro with us, and, you know, our team wasn't as strong back then with pro, so we didn't win with him in net, but we won a lot of gold medals with him. And as you know, he loves this sport more than anybody, and he's taking the reins on the New York 35 and over group, and it might not be a guy that takes more pride in a men's tournament than Pete Penicky.
No, it's so true. And to correct your statement there, Pete was part of our first pro victory in Florida.
On the bench, yeah.
On the bench. When Kramer scored the winner in overtime. Pete's been up and down the ranks in the NHL. You know, he went from originally he was working in the tickets department, you know, I guess dealing with sponsors and big names, celebrities trying to get tickets to games. And then he went over to the suspension room. So that's
pretty cool. Review all the bad hits every night on certain games. Yeah.
Yeah. I was working with like Brendan Shanahan and what's his face from LA. I'm sure he'll let us know, but yeah, he's worked with some pretty cool people. And then now he's events coordinator, you know, he's part of the events. So pretty cool. You know, Pete's living the dream. And if anyone knows Pete, it's right up his alley, you know, he loves being part of it. So it's awesome.
Nah, he does a great job. We missed him at State Wars. He was actually part of the State Wars staff, our original staff, 2005, first State Wars.
Yep.
He was one of our tournament directors, excuse me, back then. So
I still remember him. He was the board guy back then. He had his little P-touch. He was working the P-touch, making everything look perfect and nice, you know.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, he takes
pride. He loves it. Definitely takes a lot of pride in it, for sure.
Yeah.
So some good news here, Greg, that I didn't even fill you in on that I want to let you know live here. So I guess I've come into a pretty big trust. Looks like I have $5.5 million coming my way. So, you know, God only knows what we can do with State Wars with that. But I got an email yesterday. I'm going to read it to you here quick. So, dear beloved, I know it will be a great surprise reading this from me today, but consider this a divine intervention. My name is Maya Louise, a widow from Madrid, Spain. I am presently writing you to inform you from my sickbed. I've been fighting cancer. I want to entrust my $5.5 million to your care for charity purposes. And blah, blah, blah. Her late husband wants her dead, and she wants to send all this money to me. So I'm feeling pretty excited today, Greg. So I got this money coming my way. So if that happens, if this Maya Louise from Spain sends me this money, I'm going to put a $100,000 prize up for the Pro Division next summer. All continues on this money coming to me. So let's hope that Miss Louise from Madrid, Spain follows through with this email, because I'm sure I'm the only one that got this email yesterday.
Yeah, just make sure you send your account information.
Oh, yeah.
The email, so she has it.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Make sure you give your social security number as well.
I think I have to send her 20 grand to help with her bills, and then she releases the 5.5 mil to me. So
probably, yeah.
Is it crazy that people actually send these kind of emails, and that people actually, there's someone out there that actually believes in it?
It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It really is.
It's just really crazy to me. But yeah, no, it's unreal. So let's talk about the Stanley Cup real quick here. So obviously, game seven, Stanley Cup.
Game six,
the other night was finished. I always think they went seven games, went six games. Our boy Patty Maroon lifted his cup for the second year in a row with the Tampa Bay Lightning. Becoming the eighth player in NHL history to win back-to-back Stanley Cups, two different teams, which is pretty incredible. Think that number is that low in all the years the NHL has been going on. So congrats, you know, to our boy Patty Maroon, and we'll definitely get him on this pod in the next few weeks once the dust settles and his drunken parade of the Stanley Cup ends. You know, he could put Ovi to shame if he tries, I'm sure. But we'll get him on. But congrats to Pat, and what a job by the Lightning, huh?
Fantastic job. I mean, that team was just so deep this year, and it's crazy, you know, like any other year, maybe Dallas Stars, I mean, they were stacked, you know, they had such a good team, but they just came across a really hot and deep Lightning team. But yeah, I mean, from goaltending on out to the coaches, you know, everyone just did a phenomenal job, and they had great role players and defensemen, and just fun team to watch this year. You know, and Patty made a great play on that second goal, you know, out of the air. Hard to the net, drove hard and caused chaos, and there was a goal. So just great, great all-around play. And those of you who have been following him, you know, on social media and all the different social media accounts out there, seems like he's having a good time.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
A good time. So,
yeah. It feels good seeing all these fans through State Wars, you know, that are watching. I feel like there's a lot of Pat Maroon fans out there that have met him at State Wars over the years. I've seen a lot of people posting pictures of seeing him in St. Louis the one year, or in Indiana, or wherever. And that's pretty cool that all these new fans he has. You know, he's got tons of fans, such a great personality.
Yeah.
So he's got so many fans. If you, you know, you go anywhere we were talking about earlier, NHL or any other sites, there's always videos with him on there. So he's a fan favorite everywhere, but definitely the roller hockey fans definitely love him, and the State Wars fans especially. And we always thank Pat for taking the time at State Wars. He does a lot for the tournament when he comes out there, and his son Anthony always plays in it. His uncle Rob is the Missouri state director, an old friend of ours who owns All-American Rink in St. Louis.
Yeah.
Where we will have some games out at State Wars this summer, as we always do. But yeah, congrats to Patty. And, you know, I can make an argument that of all the years I've been watching hockey, that Lightning team is as good as a team when they're on their A game. I think I said it last week. I don't know if I've seen a better team than that team.
So good. I mean, Kucherov and Hedman and Points, those guys are just studs, you know. It's pretty cool to see because the two Shen brothers obviously went back-to-back as well. So that's another cool story as well. But, yeah, if anyone who watched Pat last night definitely had me laughing.
Oh, yeah.
Crying laughing, you know, shirt off, you know, doing his little speech at the stadium last night. Just a character.
Oh, yeah.
I think at the end he closed it off, closed off his speech. He's the big rig, and he's a two-time champion or whatever. However he said it,
right.
Just pretty funny. Pretty funny stuff.
And it's great with Pat too, because let's be honest, like he's not the greatest player out there. He's not Kucherov. He's not Hedman. He's not Pavelski. You know, but he's that role guy, and he embraces that role, and he plays it great. You know, and he's always a part of stuff like overtime goals in front of the net. He's passing, he's hitting, you know, he's that, like you said, knocked that puck out of the air, which shows that skill set he does have that many might not realize. And he went hard to the net and opened up the passing lane for that pass over for the goal eventually. So, you know, you need players like that. And I think that's a lesson learned to everyone, you know, watching with their children, that not everyone's going to be Kucherov out there. You know, and everyone's Braden Point. Not everyone has that skill set, but there are other things that you can do to get on teams and to play at a high level. And obviously Pat is loved by his teammates, loved by his coaching staff, does whatever he's got to do. He's a favorite in the locker room, I'm sure. And that's the big reason why Tampa signed him, to bring that experience from a year before. Because remember, Tampa the year before got knocked out in the first round by the Blue Jackets.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, he went to a great team. It's not like he went to, you know, the Florida Panthers and brought him to the Cup. But he went to a very good team that had to get over the hump. And I think he was a big part of that next level for them. And it showed by him being on the ice for many big goals for them. And just how much the team embraces him shows how much he means to that team.
Yeah, and John Cooper put it in terms where, I don't know if you saw the quote, he's a character who plays with character.
Oh, yeah.
And that's Pat in a nutshell.
100%.
Know? So that was pretty cool. And to see it come full circle – you know, those of you who don't know, Pat played with John Cooper in juniors for NAHL, where they won a national championship juniors. So that's pretty cool. I know, you know, they became the Bandits. They were down in Texarkana, and they ended up transferring to St. Louis. Pat played in his hometown, and they won a championship there. So pretty cool. Pretty cool stuff.
Great stuff. Great stuff. All right, without further ado, we're going to bring on Pete Penicky, our buddy, NHL events coordinator, home from the bubble. We'll talk to him a little bit, and then we'll get into our game for today, our PAMA Pro Playback game number two between the Tour Mudcats and Mission Black Ice.
Hey, this is Jason Miro, coach of Mission Black Ice Hockey. When I'm not home counting my gold medals, I'm listening to the State Wars Hockey Podcast.
That was Jason Muro, Mission Black Ice. We'll be watching his team later today. And here we got our buddy, Pete Penicky, home from the bubble, Long Islander. How's it going there, Pete?
It's going well, guys. What's up?
What's up, Pete?
You look like shit.
How's it feel to be home, Pete? It
feels awesome. So still trying to get adjusted to it.
72 days, Pete?
73. No one's counting, though.
Okay. I don't know what's a harder adjustment. I know from being on the road a lot, not as long as Pete was, but it's usually harder on the family to adjust to us coming home than it is to us being home. So I'm sure it's a big culture shock for the wife and kids to have you home again.
Yeah, Lindsay wants to know when the next bubble starts. No, it's good to be home, to be honest. See the kids and everything. It was great. They came to the airport to pick me up. So it's pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So Pete, let's talk a little bit about this bubble. So obviously, the NHL did an amazing job. You know, I think, you know, when things started in the summertime before even the first event, the first game, people were always questioning, like, is this going to last? Are they going to make it? Is it going to be an outbreak? You know, everyone's COVID crazy. And I would make an argument that the NHL has done a better job than any professional league and how they've handled the whole situation. It's been pretty much flawless. And I know you were a big part of the process from early on. So tell our listeners a little bit about just how crazy was it just for you personally about what you had to go through just to get there and the quarantining and the testing and how specific it was for you.
So let's say back in May, early June, find out that something's going to happen, looking to do a bubble, but it was mostly towards other cities, not Edmonton. And we found out that Vegas was one of the finalists that we were most likely going to go to in the West. Toronto was going to be in the East. So that was a shock when we found out Edmonton was changing over Vegas. So then we had to do a quick 360 turnaround
in May
to move from all our Vegas work straight to Edmonton. Had about 20 days to get situated before we found out that we were leaving as early as some staff left as early as July 14th when we found out we were heading to Edmonton July 1st. So some staff had 14 days to plan. I left on July 19th. That was the second charter. And the third charter left July 24th. So we had three different charters of staff leaving. So between the 14th and the 24th, we had about 70 full-timers head to Edmonton, put together this whole, you say, bubble hockey tournament in 20 days. So it's pretty amazing to do that. And to find out how we had to deal with the testing is, you know, 4 days prior to leaving, we got our tests, our COVID test sent to us, and it was a spit test, which we had to Zoom a doctor, sit in front of a doctor in the Zoom and spit inside of a container for 25 minutes to get to a size of a vial that was eligible, go to UPS that same day, drop it off in the mail, and get our results the next day. We had to make sure we had four green lights before we were able to board the plane. So it was pretty.
Now, when you were at the bubble, do they take temperature every time you walked in every day?
Every day we had a clear app. So I don't know if many of you are familiar with the clear app. It's Delta, which is, it's known at the airports, mostly Delta that runs it. But every employee had to download, as well as a player, staff, anyone inside the bubble had to download the app. And every day we had to show, you know, go up the machine, get our temperature read to us, show the nurse and the security a green, it was like a green light on your phone. If you didn't have it, right. If you had a red one, you had to see the nurse, which meant some people actually had to quarantine for a day because some people actually ran temperatures, whatever. But so they'd sit in a hotel room for 24 hours just to make sure. But nothing was ever, I mean, nothing came out of it. It was just, you know, a quick quarantine for 24 hours. People were fine. But you had to do that, and then you had to walk inside. I don't know if any
of you. Thank God this didn't happen back in the 70s, or else you would have had to bend over every day and you would have been pretty sore by the end of the 73 days.
So then we went to the arena, we went to Rogers Place, walked to Rogers Place every day inside of like a cage fence. You know, no outside public was allowed, just a bunch of security guards working, standing every 12 feet. It felt like you were military, the way they respected you. They just like everyone's, hi, sir, thank you, sir. It was really respectful in that way. Got to the arena, and then there was 12 to 14 lanes full of nurses, doctors, just every day had to do a throat swab or a nose swab every day to get tested, and found out that's how we did it every day. Players had to do it. No matter who was going inside the arena, had to get tested every day, no matter who you were. And if you missed it, if the players missed it, they weren't able to play the game or something. So everyone had to do it.
Now, did you ever wake up in the morning some days and want to just put take temperature, put your head to a light bulb all day and get in with a fever and be able to get sent home?
So between the days 40 and 50, I would say I was hoping to be red every day.
Yeah,
just exhausted, just, you know, working long days, just you had enough, you know, it was just repetitive. You know, I know you guys always say the food, but I only had four different restaurants to eat at, so it got really repetitive. Sometimes I just wish to stay inside my bed for 24 hours and not, you know, look at blank walls. It would probably be more relaxing. But at the end of the day, it was pretty awesome once you got to the rink to see this happen in front of you. And it was, and I love hockey, you know that. So just watch hockey and deal with it all day. It was pretty amazing.
Yeah, I'm going to show a quick little two-minute video here. So Pete, like I said, he is the NHL, but one of the NHL event coordinators. He was in charge of the practice facility in Edmonton, where teams would practice every day. And so here's a quick little video. It's you know, an hour long thing. I'm going to show a little clip here. So there's a little bit of the inside of the bubble. Obviously, this was taken at the beginning of the playoffs, so all the teams were still involved. And it's pretty funny watching a John Cooper speech here at the beginning, knowing that they wound up winning the cup.
Yeah.
And then a little bit from Pete. and some of his co-workers that were in the other facility in Toronto as well. So let's watch this for a sec.
It is really hard to win, and especially the opponent we are playing. All you guys have done is rise to the occasion. You've done everything we have asked from this pause all the way on. You stuck it out here, all right? And we got over a D, all right? Now we've got another one. Be responsible. Play for each other, fellas. Let's go.
The 2020 Stanley Cup playoffs may have a different look, but the game on the ice is as intense as ever.
We gotta go.
Continue from leaving each other, and we'll come back here, boys.
In the playoffs, even a small adjustment can make or break a team. And where the teams practice is just as critical as where they play.
The practice facility here in Toronto has three NHL rinks. It is home to the Marlies, which is the AHL team for the Leafs, as well as the Leafs. It does have a good NHL feel.
This facility in Edmonton is a multi-sheet facility. The only negative thing here is the space is not as big as Toronto, which was a little issue, but we were able to use every piece available to make teams happy.
My role for the bubble here in Edmonton is taking care of all the transportation needs to and from the practice arena, as well as the equipment staff and trainers to and from Terwilliger. Typically, there's eight buses that need to fit into a spot where two buses fit. So we've gotten pretty good at playing bus Tetris in the morning.
Before we came here, we had to get all this new power installed for each rink. So each rink got installed four of these, as well as four of the 10 socket 20 by 40. So the running joke we have with the arena here is that we put enough power in this facility to power the whole city of Edmonton.
Similar to Pete in Edmonton, we'd had some power concerns. That was one of our biggest obstacles that we need to overcome.
Right now in the Avalanche locker room, the practice rink, as you can see, they had a game yesterday, but this is all leftover stuff they leave from the practice rink. This is all their practice stuff where they, at Rogers Place, they have a game set. And they, as you can see, they have a practice set as well. So it's easier, fans running, nice massage bed to feel good. From day one we moved in, Colorado never had to leave. So they're able to put up some signage because they don't have to take it down. Just make it feel like a more homier thing. Mats for the guys' sandals and skates. Just make it feel like the guys in Colorado right now.
So great stuff there, Pete. That'd be pretty fun being a part of that video. They obviously thought of everything with these guys, and later on they talk about getting haircuts and all the entertainment they got to do, which was pretty awesome. And I know just from being on the road for 2 weeks with the Team USA team, how guys are always itching to do stuff. So how fun was it just being a part of that whole process?
You know, I don't know if it was fun. It's pretty remarkable. It's something that I'm going to be able to talk about the rest of my life to the kids. And I don't know if it's ever going to happen again where you can say you're going to be on the road for 73 days straight.
Hope not.
Running a Stanley Cup event that actually worked better than anyone that expected it. And the one thing about that video that you didn't, that wasn't really mentioned was, is when we first, the practice facility, which I ran, my buddy Vince, who was in that, his practice facility was located right next to Scotiabank Arena in Toronto. Ours was a half hour away from the Rogers Place, which originally we thought when hockey ops came, tested, making sure the ice was good at Terwilliger when after we were done setting up, we always had that feeling that, you know what, the players are not going to like the half-hour drive. It's going to get to them. It was totally opposite. Players loved going to practice half-hour away because they got to see green grass. They got to see civilization. You know, when you're in this bubble, all it was a lot of concrete. So people walked out of their hotel, and you were just around concrete and big buildings. So to go to the practice facility, it was actually opposite. Players loved to go to the practice facility. The workout area was amazing. They spent more time than we originally planned on it. So we thought the players were going to hate it at first because of the drive and the amenities, but it was totally opposite, which was a good feeling knowing that you set something up that players loved. And it was nice when general managers came up to myself and said, you know, this place is great. You guys should be proud, you know, just, you know, always complimenting us how great it was. And to see general managers come to look at a practice was pretty amazing when, you know, there's nothing else to do. So more of the staff, when each team was only allowed 52 people in, you know, inside the bubble, most of those people all came to practice and watch it. So it's pretty cool to meet new people. You know, I've been with the league for 15 years, never met some of these people. It was just good getting to know their names. They knew your name by the time they left. It was pretty, pretty good. Yeah. Some night that guy had. Unbelievable.
Yeah, so we're talking about our buddy Pat Maroon. And just like us, you know Patty for a long time in the family. So how special was it again for you to be able to see someone as a friend there and then get so much attention, deservedly so, and then win again. How special was that moment to share that with them?
You know, last year was pretty cool being in St. Louis for the whole event, seeing the family, you know, doing good old Phil all day, every day with the phone calls, the texts. But you got to appreciate that because Phil, I think, thinks he's an NHL player sometimes. And I think he thinks he's Pat sometimes. But overall, that whole family is great to be around. But this was totally different. And the coolest thing of all is, I never told you this, is when Tampa arrived to the hotel, actually myself and a couple of staff members were in the lobby just having a couple of drinks, and Pat walked in right away. The first person you saw, and he made a big deal in front of everyone. I was like, what's up, Pasta Pete? Everyone turned around, looked like, what the hell? He came over, gave me a big hug. So it was pretty cool that, you know, like, you know, all these people looking at me like, who's this clown, you know, hugging this hockey player when you're not supposed to hug anyone, but, you know, he comes over and a big bear hug from him.
Right.
It was good to see him every day.
I'd feel pretty good for him too, being, you know, he didn't have his family with him here like he did in St. Louis. So to see a good buddy away from all this up there too, had to be pretty cool for him as well to be able to share that moment with someone who's a friend outside of the NHL world, like teammates and whatnot.
Yeah, we spent some time together. We hung out, you know, we talked a lot, you know, after practices, we'll hang around with him for a bit, you know, before practices. So, you know, we weren't able to really do any dinners or breakfasts just based on his schedule because there's always team meals. And, you know, they got there when the harder rounds were, where Toronto, I wish, you know, I was there just to hang out with him more when he had more downtime compared to here. It was a game every day, you know, pregame skates next day. So, you know, he was all business, which I respected that. And, you know, it was just good to hang out with him, see him, especially the day he got the cup. It was pretty cool, you know, hang out with him and everything and just see what a character he is when he gets really, really intoxicated.
Oh, yeah, we know how he is. And but, we got a shout out here.
Put it this way. I respect that because every guy loves him on that team. It's nuts. Like, they all call him Big Dog, Big Rig. Like, everyone, you know, he came in with the cup with Sam Coach. When they first got into the locker room, they made sure, you know, they made a lot of specials about him. It was pretty cool. It was well-deserved, you know. He didn't play a lot of minutes, but being in an arena that's quiet with no fans, all you hear is his mouth.
Yeah.
You think I'm loud on the bench rooting for people? He makes me seem quiet. I mean, he's just always talking to people, always starting shit up in the corners. You always hear his mouth, the refs when he gets a penalty. It's awesome to hear.
And we talked about earlier all those intangibles that he brings. And you know, Paul Rogers gives a shout out. Hey, Pete, on our live pod here, saying hello. Our old buddy of yours from who's living out in Hawaii now says hello to you.
Paul's a good guy. Known Paul for a while. Give that guy a lot of respect.
So, Greg, you had a question here for Pasta?
Yeah, I got a bunch. Pete, now, when Toronto was finished, did all the workers from Toronto come over, or were they able to go home?
About 80% of the workers went home. We got about a dozen that came from Toronto to Edmonton. But, I mean, we were pretty much lock and loaded 50 days. You know, they were in Toronto for 50 days. We were pretty much lock and loaded in Edmonton. It was just pretty much executives and certain departments that came. Some people left Edmonton and got replaced from people, you know, people left with families. So other people in departments replaced them now in Toronto who were able to stay longer. But overall, it's mostly just all Edmonton people there from day one to day, you know, day 73.
Yes. So you got the rookie shift.
I wouldn't exactly say that. I feel like I was a veteran. You know, I got respected, you know, being there, you know, so many years here now. It was definitely cool being there from day one to the last day, seeing everything develop. Like, I'm happy to this day, even though it was long, you know, gone 23 days longer, to actually be there the final day we left to see everything happen. I would have been upset if I wasn't there putting all this, you know, not being on Toronto side. So that was, you might say, oh, that sucks, but it was actually a different feeling.
Yeah, to see it just full swing.
Oh,
just
completely.
From start to finish.
I mean, it was in the first couple of weeks, it was, you know, it was painful days, man. They were long days, you know, never went to sleep, always, you know, at the arena 5:30 in the morning, getting home at 7 o'clock at night, eating dinner, going to bed, repetitive for like, but you know, when you have 12 teams there, it's massive. Where when, you know, four teams left, that's where it was nice. You know, one game a day, it was just got to work later in the afternoon, you know, so it was cool.
Now, the players, I mean, it seems like they kind of had it made there. You know, they had a lot of events and they had, you know, all different sports they could play, water events.
Yeah, that was Toronto. Toronto had more of those different type of events just based on where they were. Like, some of the teams took advantages of excursions we had. Like, Vegas went on a lot of excursions where, you know, our amenities weren't as good as Toronto, but our, you know, our departments that do that did a great job of what they were able to do. Like, you know, we had this football field called Commonwealth where the former Eskimos of Edmonton play, which was a nice turf field. Guys got to go there, play spike ball, soccer, kick field goals. It was cool to see some fake grass and some stands to get out in the sun. you know, in our plaza. I don't know if you saw the plaza. We had basketball set up. There was some street hockey. There was cornhole. I mean, it wasn't the best looking area, but, you know, at nighttime there was fires, you know, Adirondack chairs to hang out. So it was good what you can, you know, what you had to play with. Yeah, I thought we did a good enough job as a league to handle what we can.
And I'm sure, like, the younger guys, it's easier, right? When you don't have families and they could just, they're just hanging out. Because I even know for myself, when I was in Slovakia for 18 days, you know, I have a wife, kids. There came a point, even in the middle of that, where I just would get bored and I just start thinking, like, oh, I miss my kids. I miss this. I'm bored. Where the younger guys were out every day running around, finding something to do and just sleeping, hanging out, drink, whatever they want to do. And they're not even thinking about anything because they're just having fun, which is great to be that age. So I got to think at the NHL level, especially how long they're going, the guys that had families, it's got to be tougher than those young guys. And that's why I loved Vancouver Canucks really early on and watching them. They had so many young players. I felt like those guys had such an advantage during this because they probably weren't sad to be there as much or missing home as much as some of the older guys.
Yeah, I mean, they had some nice meal rooms in the hotels. You know, guys, like I said before, guys stayed at practice a lot longer than anticipated. Like, usually some of the veterans would practice for 40 minutes in a typical Stanley Cup, get off the ice, go home. You know, there really wasn't anything to do, you know. So these guys are always together, you know, taking advantage of what they can. Guys just hung out in the quad a lot, drinking coffee, just socializing. It was good to see other teams mingle with other teams in the quad. Like, guys, you know, who played with each other, just hanging out. It was a good feel like that. You know what I mean? We also had a golf simulator set up in the arena, which I never knew this, but I never realized how much NHL players love that game, pickleball. You guys know what that is?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Kyle Kramer is a big pickleball guy.
Oh, I think I told you one day, Greg, I just started learning to play it. I mean, it's an awesome game, but I mean, I tell you one thing, the Tampa Bay Lightning can destroy anybody in the pickleball too. It's unbelievable to watch those guys play pickleball. But, you know, they had some things to do outside. You know, there was some, wasn't much grass, but there was enough to go outside and hang out. Guys that had lunch outside, there was patio areas guys can do. But, you know, we had some food trucks guys took advantage of. So it was cool in that sense.
That is cool. Now, I saw, you know, you were there during the Kentucky Derby. So did you head that up? I saw a picture of you
We got to head up right now. So yes and no. I somehow helped put that party together. Like, we were originally going to do a small little office party. You know, guys wanted to, you know, bet, you know, get some horses together, you know, picking a horse out of a name, whatever. Next thing we know, it was an off day. I don't know if you knew that was between games. So the game one was played in Toronto that night, game seven. It was the Islanders Fly game, which received awesome ratings because of Kentucky Derby lead-in. But it ended up just being this huge party at Studio 99, which is the bar lounge in the Rogers Place. And I'm having a couple hundred people in there, staff, players, and everything. Next thing I know it, I got asked to be the MC, started announcing the race, started announcing calls. And next thing you know, boom, race is over. I got fired. No. But yeah, I ended up being a little bit of a spearhead on that too. But it was pretty cool. You know, loving horse racing so much, being involved, it was pretty cool.
We know, like, Pete loves his ponies, Greg. So.
Yeah, he's like the Eddie Olczyk of the NHL.
Yeah, too bad. I don't make situations like he does. He makes good decisions. Pete, he makes bad decisions.
So, Pete, besides the Stanley Cup playoffs, the other huge thing going on this summer, of course, was State Wars. And I know how much that tournament means to you. And I know deep down it had to be killing you to be there and not with the boys at State Wars, how much you look forward to that tournament and the 35 and over team and whatnot. And I'm sure you were chatting back and forth and finding out what's going on and watching live and checking things out. So even though obviously you miss your family, you miss everything, I'm sure you miss being there this summer, huh?
You know that. You don't have to bring that up. You know, it's already killing me right now talking about it. But yes, I look forward for that every year. You know, I would have probably been there for 3 weeks myself there, just doing nothing there. But I did miss it. You know, I was upset. You know, we lost in the finals. Happy that we got to the finals as usual. But, you know, it sucked. But getting ready to see the boys in November, which I'm excited about. You know, booking my hotel room probably from Halloween night till Christmas night there. So be ready to go. But, you know
one of the things that's very special with our group, and I know some of the Missouri guys are like this, but so people that don't know at home, you know, so when I first coached Pete in 1996, you know, some of the guys that we had part of our group then are still part of our group now in 35 and over, you know, Sean McGrath, you know, from Valley Stream, who's captain, one of the captains of the 35 and over team. His younger brother, Danny, who wasn't on our team but played for me on a younger team, is part of it. Derek Kern, who was part of our original team. Brian Richford doesn't play, but he's there working. So he's kind of part of it because he's there.
He's definitely part of it. He's like, he's a player without a stick on a team. You know he is.
Now he's secretly rooting against us, I think. you know, and Greg, who wasn't part of our original group, but he came on pretty early on with the group. So we have so many guys that have been together so long and still getting to see each other a couple times a year at tournaments. And to me, that's what makes it so special. And I know it's always great to be able to play with your buddies and obviously win a gold medal with your friends.
It's like I tell Sean, I talk to Sean just about every day. And, you know, we just, you know, talk horses or just talk hockey. And it's pretty amazing that you look back, like you said, 95, 96, 25 years later, how good of buddies we still are. And it's all through roller hockey. Like, you know, we still have that tribe, you know, with 40 years old now, some of us, you know, you're 50, Greg's almost 40, about to have four kids. But overall, you know, you still have that hungry feeling. And it's awesome knowing that you go away. We always joke, oh, you know, how much everyone loves as much as everyone else does. Like you, everyone pretends they don't follow things. You know, I'll call out Jimmy Lynch right now. He knows the locker rooms for full invitational before you even did it yet. Like everyone pretends they don't care. Everyone loves it just as much as everyone else. And it's good to have that everyone loves this. And it's such a good to be with the guys. Like that's what I love more than anything is just hanging out with the guys, the locker room giggles, you know, they're talking shit of one another, usually on me, but it's okay.
Now we have another New York team, 35-0, the Empire, you know, Frankie Peretti and Pudge Cull and Gary Cull, Ryan Carey, Carmelo Stracuzzi. So these are all guys, a lot of them were snipers at one time. You know, there's only so many guys you could have on a team, Greg. And then now another team spins off and starts that gave you guys some fits. And as Greg has even told me, there's other guys coming up the ranks now, probably 35 and over that want to play that. There might be a third team gets spun out of this. Who knows? So
eventually.
So it's just growing, and it's great to see the 35 has become almost like the new pro division, so to speak. There's so many great players playing just at a little slower and older age, but that division is becoming so important to guys, and I love seeing it.
It's definitely competitive, especially, you know, I wasn't there this year, which, you know, but last year when you the first time you did AAA, every game was a great game. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like Greg would just laugh about it now because it's over, but like it was weird. Like last year we were celebrating ties in the locker room because it meant so much, but it's pathetic that you're celebrating ties because every point meant something. But right. You know, like that back in the day, some of those times, you know, when we first started, when we played together, Tim, at 35 at the beginning, we would go win 3 games, 8-0. It was awful. Like you'd be like, this sucks. Now it's like every game means something. It feels like back in the day playing juniors or, you know, when we first started playing pro, like, you know, every game means something. That's how it is now, too.
Yeah.
No, the Empire is always going to be a good team. Those guys are all good guys. You know, Pudge, Carmel, Frankie, you know, they're all good guys. And they're all good hockey players, too. You know, it's not like we're one, they're two. It's like, you know, we're both 1-1A. They're a good team.
100%.
So,
100%. You know, I don't like ties. Ties like a loss for
me. I know. You're celebrating a tie. It's 2-2. I'm not going to tell you the team. We tied so-and-so.
All right, people. It was great having you today. You know, we're gonna follow up here. We're gonna go into where we've been doing these PAMA Pro playbacks. So we're gonna cover a game that happened over the summer between the Mudcats and Black Ice. I'm gonna let you get back to your family. I know it's been a long haul for you, and we really appreciate you taking the time, and we appreciate all you do in the sport.
One more thing about the Pro is VO taking your spot at the top of Pro in these days, Tim, as the coach of the year.
Hey,
him and Jay Miro, huh?
Yeah, they both beat me this year, you know. So
I don't know. According to Richie Morano, you might be number 3 in the list in the Long Island coaches these days.
I think I am after the summer. They both beat me, so.
No.
Coach Zito's going up, too.
It's finally good seeing VO going up in the ranks. You know, that guy's been part of roller hockey 25 years. It's good to see his boys starting to, you know, get recognition. They got some good guys in that team. So it's finally good to see VO becoming.
VO's doing a great job. And, you know, Pete, it's always good for business to lose once in a while. That's what I always say when I lose. So, you know, but no, those guys did a great job and they beat us pretty handily, both of them. So, today we're going to cover the Mudcats playing Black Ice, which was a great game. Some great players in that. CJ Yoder, as you know, still doing it somehow at the pro level. And he was playing pro when we were starting out. So it's amazing how long
he's something else. He's the Tom Brady of roller hockey for sure. I'll tell you that.
100%.
So.
All right, Peter, guys. Great having you. We'll talk to you soon, bud.
All right, talk to you later.
Right. See you later. All right. It's one of the characters in the game right there, Pete Penicky. Let's hear from CJ Yoder right now.
Hey, guys. CJ Yoder here, captain of the Tour Mudcats. When I'm not bathing in the fountain of youth in my backyard, I'm listening to State Wars podcast. You guys should be too.
Well, it definitely is a fountain of youth in his backyard, Greg. At 40 plus, the go to roller hockey.
45 plus, Tim.
Yeah, he must be hitting 45 now. I got to watch out for him in the 45 and over division. So, yeah, I mean, we'll see in this game we're going to bring up now that he definitely isn't slowing down and can still play. So
that's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, so let's talk about this next game here, Greg. So we got the Tor Mudcats, Mission Black Ice. This was a big game for both of these teams here. It was their, I know for sure it was Black Ice's second game of the day. I'm not sure if it was the Mudcats' first or second. But, you know, really good game here. A lot to cover. I know we had over 1,500 views of our playback of last week's game. A lot of emails and texts from people loving it. Cool. Things we were going over with and whatnot. So hopefully we'll continue with that today here on this game.
Yeah, and, you know, for those of you who haven't seen the replay yet, you know, it is on YouTube. The game's also on YouTube as well. And you can go back and watch, you know, the previous podcasts on YouTube. Or you can go to our Facebook page. But also uploaded today was the the Mudcat Black Ice game. The full game is on YouTube. So if you want to go and check it out, go ahead. You know, it's on our YouTube page.
All right, perfect. So here we got Tor Mudcats, Black Ice. And the first thing here, you know, real quickly into the game, it wasn't the hugest play, but just an example of protecting the puck and not protecting the puck here. So we're going to see here, Ryan Gault, puck to the boards here. And he doesn't protect the puck, Greg. And it causes a quick two-on-one. And those are two guys there, KJ Tiffenworth and Billy Pascal, you definitely don't want to turn the puck over to. So let's watch it again here. So Gault, simple play. We can see he goes in nonchalant here, GT. And KJ, who's one of the best in the business, pops it off his stick, goes in quick, two-on-one. And big save here by Clay Taylor. And we're going to hear that a lot today.
Yeah. It looked like Gault you know, he went to the boards a little funny, I think. I don't know if it was just nonchalant or he just kind of hit an edge, you know, but it's a great play by KJ. And yeah, it's deadly 2-on-1 right there. So big save by Clay.
And as you know, if a team scores right away in a game, Greg, like what's your mentality there? Like to me, I think a lot of guys, you know, when teams score like first shift on you definitely see guys get down, you know, and a big save like that could do the opposite for you. So they score really quick there, Black Ice. And you know, we'll see what the outcome of this game is, but that could change the whole game, a goal in the first shift.
Yeah, it's huge. You know, it's really big momentum-wise. But, you know, again, these games are so long that, you know, anything could happen.
And we're talking all day today about face-offs, Greg. I think we're gonna cover at least 5 or 6 face-offs today. We covered a lot last week. And watching some of these games, I just don't think face-offs are discussed as much as I think they should be, as much as you and I talk about them, I know. But here's an example, again, of, you know, players not lining up three across. And for those at home, when we talk about lining up three across, you know, what we're talking about is this area. So see this area here, okay? This is that neutral area where a lot of times the pucks wind up to the boards. And when the Mudcats are back here, there's all this room now they have to get to cover where KJ is right here. So any 50-50 puck to the boards there, he's going to come away with, right, Greg? And Black Ice is going to control the puck. And we'll see this face of what happens here. So see there, that puck winds up at the boards, Greg. KJ's uncontested, easy pass back now. They reset the puck. Whereas if this player here was up on the boards, it'd be a battle for that puck right now.
Yeah, 100%, Tim. You know, I'm also, I know, you know, I tell you this a lot. If I'm Black Ice, I have four across there, okay? Obviously, they won the draw. It was no big deal. But, you know, if that puck's won all the way back, you know, into the defensive zone, KJ Tiefenworth should be able to get that puck easily, even if Kozlo isn't there. Because there's no one on the inside. I'm sorry, on the outside here. Shooting out to the point, you know, there's just two guys there, one on each team, just kind of, you know, defending one another. But there's no one shooting out to the point there. So there's a lot of room for a guy to walk in if it draws one back.
No, for sure. And we're gonna come up here to another play. I'm going to let you jump in here.
Dennis, not a short walk at all. Battle on the boards.
I'm going to grab
Yeah. Well, I'm going to rewind it back quick, Tim.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, here, guys, you know, Clay Taylor, of course, comes up big again. You know, I like Kafuk's little battle here on the boards. Wins a nice battle. Came down pretty hard on his stick, but, you know, it's a marginal play there. You know, could have been a penalty maybe, but he works hard, wins that battle. Black Ice gets the puck, and Gerger makes a great pass.
I love this pass by Big 92, Nate Gerger. And, you know, he's one of those guys for me that when I watch this game, I'm just more and more in love with his game. You know, I think he's one of those guys on this team. He gets overlooked sometimes because there's so many high-level players on black ice. And I'm sure if you talk to Jay Muro, when it's your own guys, he'll just speak, you know, I'm sure novels about how great Nate is and how important he is. But I just love his pass here because I don't think that a lot of defensemen in our game would make this pass. You know, they would pull back. They would try to force something. I love how Nate just immediately gets it, boom, recognizes an odd man break, sends it out, and here we go. Another two-on-one. Another big save by Clay Taylor. So here we are, Greg. We're only a couple minutes into the game, and Black Ice has had two pure two-on-ones where Clay Taylor has come up big.
Yeah, and that's a team you don't want having odd-man rushes because they'll make you pay. Clay came out big.
Yeah. Now we're going to be leading up to a goal here. And again, I'm going to talk Nate Gerger again here. I love what Nate does here. And here's Nate Gerger. Let's point him out for everybody. So here's Nate right here. And here, I love the way he directs traffic here to Tyler Kraft, who's over here. And I don't think he's telling him to get to the boards, which winds up what Tyler does to get this puck. I think he's directing him to watch this guy on D behind him. But it's just a great communication all around. And I love here in the corner how Matt Gerger, another great player, runs in the family, makes a battle, and Kafuk comes in. And I'm not clear or not if he saw Tyler Kraft or not here or just played it softly around the boards to him. But it's just a great goal all around. Let's let it run through here, and we'll talk about it. So here's Nate Poynton.
Battle in the corner. Kraft takes a shot, scores! Tyler Kraft walks in and roofs that one, and Kraft said, I am here, and I'm making it 1-0.
So now Tyler Kraft, GT, he's not known for his goal scoring, really. Like, he's known as that passer, right? He's that smart kid, makes the right play. You don't know him just sniping pucks. That was a snipe.
Oh, that was a snipe. But I just love the awareness of Kafuk. I think he knew he was there the whole time. You know, going into a play like that, you have to be aware of where your teammates are at all times, right? And he knew. He made that great play around the boards to Tyler. And I think that's one Clay Taylor wants back for sure, because I'm sure there wasn't much to shoot at. But it was a great shot by Tyler.
Yeah, amazing shot. You know, off the leg up, snapshot, beautiful goal. And that's an example to our youngsters out there about just snapping the puck far in a goal. Not a big, huge windup, just a quick snapper on net. And he didn't force the play. So 1-0 Black Ice right there. And we're going to forward here a little bit further to a play with number 55, PJ DiMartino, who's one of the best in the game and one of our favorites. Here's a play with PJ where I feel like he's just trying to do a little too much, trying to get a little too fancy. And I'd love to see PJ just shoot this puck.
Ryan Gault with the puck. Clears it across. And it hopped over the stick of Ethan Frank. DiMartino back.
So see PJ there, Greg. He breaks in. He's got a step. They just scored a goal. I'd love to see him put one. I know he loves that top corner as well. And instead, you know, he's this unselfish guy. He tries to hold it and then hit the late man here who's covered. And they wind up getting nothing out of it.
For Black Ice, tried to clear it in front. That's broken up out the
defense. I would love to see the shot there from PJ.
Yeah, he definitely could have shot the puck there. I think it was Lauren Barron back there, made a great play. You know, he had a stick on puck. I don't know if PJ kind of got intimidated with the shot because the stick was in the lane. I thought Lauren Barron made a great play there.
Yeah. Now here's a big play in the game here now, and it's going to wind up leading to the second goal for Black Ice. So big no-no here about getting caught behind the net, Greg. And here's bad luck by the Mudcats. Not only do two guys collide, but then a third man, you know, Turnbull gets caught behind the net. Now they have three behind the net, and it's off to the races for Black Ice. Let's watch.
Start out. Or gets it up on the wing. Turnbull cleared in front. That one's off a skate, and back comes Black Ice. Gerger pushes it ahead to Coslow. Coslow comes 2-on-1 with Schultz. Over to Schultz. Schultz fires. One scores. It's a 2-0 game. Black Ice takes an early 2-goal lead against the Mudcats.
What are your thoughts on that play there, Greg?
Yeah, like you said before, bad luck. Guys got bunched up, got caught. That was Tyler Kraft with the goal. Wasn't Derek Schultz. But, you know, great play by Kaz. You know, he saw that seam, fed that puck up, and made a great play.
Was that Crafty there as well for that goal?
Actually, it might have been Derek.
Yeah, that's Schultz on that goal there.
That is. Yeah, I'm sorry. My apologies, Derek.
Derek doesn't get a lot of them, so let's not take him away from when he gets a big one.
Like my apologies, Derek. That was a snipe and a half. I saw the six, so I thought it was Tyler. You know, UPA kids, Philly kids look alike. So, but no, great overall play by Coslow here too. You know, he saw that team and he buried.
And that's got to be huge for Coach Jay Muro, right, and Aaron Weiss, that, you know, Derek Schultz is going out there to work hard, to bang, to get in there, to cause some ruckus. You're not putting him out there to score goals necessarily. Goes out there and gets a big goal like that. When you get a goal like that from your third line checker, I guess, kind of guy, that's got to be huge for your team.
Yeah, totally. And the confidence level goes up with Derek, you know. So I think overall that's a great play and awesome shot.
No, 100%. I want to watch a play here. You know, talk about some good defense. You know, I'm a big fan, I have been a long time, of Sky Lahore's game. And I want to watch a play here, him breaking up a play. You know, one of the best skaters in the game, even though I know he's always crying about his knee or his hip or his old age or whatever he is, but he's still one of the best skaters in the game, in my opinion. And he makes a great defensive play here.
Well, thank you, sir. Pascali, Tiffenworth to the outside, broken up by.
No, it may seem simple to some home, but there you got KJ Tiffenworth coming down, who's so sneaky around the net. And what I love about Skyle there, he didn't go down, he didn't do anything, he just stayed puck, stick on puck, focused on his man, didn't worry about anyone else behind him. He knew Lauren Barron had the other man, and that was good teamwork, good communication by the Mudcats to break up a deadly pair.
Yeah, I've seen KJ score on that angle plenty of times. You know, he likes going to the stick with a quick shot there, and Skyler shut him down there with that play with his stick. So, yeah, Skyler, you know, he was an old Team USA roommate and teammate of mine, and I love playing with him. Awesome player, awesome kid, and great defenseman.
Yeah, recently got married too, so congratulations to Skyler.
Yeah.
All right, here's another play here. Let's watch this one through.
Some NFL teams have already mapped out their stadium, like Miami,
for 20%
for 15,000 people. That's not bad.
Right.
Somebody getting out.
Yeah, for sure.
So I'm going to stop it right there, Greg. I love that play by Cal Kafuk. Mm-hmm. You know, we're going to talk a lot about Cal today. You know, he's the new 44 of this tournament for Black Ice with John Schiavo not there. He took that spot, which is big skates to fill for sure. And I think Cal did a tremendous job. And what I like what he does here is a lot of guys would come in here and try to force something. He just comes in, sees a simple play, 2-on-1 on, I think it's Kraft there. And he just comes in and just chips it back and resets it. And let's fight another day here. Let's watch it again.
That's not bad.
Right.
Still somebody getting out.
Yeah, for sure.
Simple back.
Yeah. Reset.
What's that?
Reset the play. And, you know, just like I said before, he's got awesome rink awareness. You know, he knows where his teammates are at all times.
No, and it leads to this play here now, and you would never have had this play if it wasn't that play. And Greg, this might be the best play, the best pass in the entire tournament that no one saw, okay? I watched this 20 times over and again the other day, and I'm going to go out and buy a Nate Gerger jersey after watching this game. You know, he makes another tremendous pass here. They don't score on it, but this pass is unreal, Greg.
Getting any worse.
I mean, any seats they have filled is good for them. Here we go.
Set up ahead, Kraft for number two. Fights off a slash.
Let's watch that again, Greg. And it's such a good pass to camera guys. Not that they're so great either, but that they don't even catch this. They're behind on it. But this pass, Greg, it's from a few steps over from behind their own net and hits a guy at center ice, basically, with a man all over him on the tape and sends in for a breakaway that they want to draw a power play on.
It's not like Miami can get any worse.
I mean, any seats they have filled is good for them. Here we go.
Set up ahead, Kraft for number two. Fights off a slash. And
they draw the penalty. I mean, as a defenseman, Greg, you pride yourself on your headman passes or whatever. That's a pass.
No, it's a pass and a half there. But you have to give kudos to Kraft there for getting open. You know, there was a man on him pretty tight, and he kind of maneuvered his way and his stick length. you know, using his stick to get open. And he created that opportunity for Nate to give him that pass. But it's great hard work by Kraft and awesome pass by Nate.
So let's check out a little bit of this. You know, Black Ice, to me, you know, it's hard to beat them when you take penalties. Like, they're a power play team to me. I would love to see the numbers on even strength goals as opposed to power play goals from Black Ice in their tenure in the pro division. They're definitely a power play team. They survive and they win and lose a lot on the power play. And here, let's watch a great play and a great save on KJ Tiffenworth, who's one of the most deadly players on the off wing there, on the right side.
Or a turnaround if you could score shorthanded, like I saw earlier this afternoon.
Absolutely.
With Black Ice.
And Black Ice is so dangerous shorthanded. Absolutely dangerous.
Big face-off win.
Raph Piscotty, back door up.
Rewind that a second here, Greg. So let's look at the position a little bit. So Black Ice does a typical, they're in a box, they're going low to high, which opens things up a lot. I love seeing the low to high play and then across. And I think Cody Bovee down low, number 69, the Mudcats, I think gets caught a little too low here, Greg, and we'll highlight that and gives KJ a little bit. I think KJ wants this one back. I think 9 out of 10, KJ buries this, GT.
Yeah, totally. I think Cody got a little lost. He should have maybe played here.
So right there.
Yeah.
You got to assume his man here, Lauren Barron's gotten back to him a little bit. If he decided here, maybe, you know, maybe come a little higher, maybe here, Cody back a foot, that pass is never going to get through here. Instead, everyone, look at all three men's eyes. Look at everyone's eyes here. Everyone is just totally puck focused here on the man with the puck. KJ sliding in. And of course, an unselfish play by his counterpart, Billy Piscotty. Usually this is an empty net goal. I think it might hit Bovee here, Greg, which kudos to him for making up for that. And then it deflects on to Taylor, I believe, and then hits the post.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to tell, but KJ did a good job of going in and out of the lane. But Cody definitely should have threw his head back and just to make sure, you know, just to see where KJ was. But great pass.
Back tore off the crossbar.
I think he missed it too.
And he didn't get good wood on.
I know that feeling all too well, Greg, with a roller hockey puck, especially, you know, you play guys that play a lot of ice knows that puck sits perfect. You take those one timers, the roller puck, not always easy to one time that puck the way it flips a little bit. And you can tell PJ it waffled on KJ, excuse me, a little bit there.
Yeah, no, totally. Didn't get all of it, but he definitely had enough to bury. And to me, that play right there, that's one of the biggest plays of the game. You know, it could have been a 3-0 lead for Black Ice there, which would have helped them big time later in the game.
If they go up 3-0, Greg, it's probably a done game.
Yes, totally.
All right, let's watch this here a little bit.
About that, but I had top five.
Got it. It's hard. Roller hockey jerseys are hard.
It's hard. There's too much grief.
I love this play by Clay Taylor here, Greg. It's going to seem, again, like a simple play, but it's not. He comes out and doesn't just stop the puck because he recognized that pressure's coming, I think, from KJ here. And he uses his body, and then he almost – it's like he corrals the puck and headmans it for him all in one motion. Let's just watch. I really like this play by Taylor.
There he is.
See a little flip, Greg?
Have we done any shout-outs yet?
Just like that there. I think that's a great play by Taylor that goes unnoticed here by a lot.
Yep, I like that play as well.
Going to forward here a little bit, Greg, to the 1306. Mar, I know you had something to talk about here, so let's let it roll.
I see downtown George Brown. What's your record currently? 2-0?
2-0.
Whoa.
Golly, sent that one wide.
Let's watch that a little bit here again, Greg. So,
yeah.
Currently 2-0.
Right there.
Whoa.
You good here?
Yep. Right here, the puck goes around. Keep playing it. And Coslow here makes a great play on his backhand, knowing that, you know, again, like we talked about before, rink awareness of where his teammates are, and throws a puck, you know, D to D, makes a great pass over to his defenseman over there, and created a two-on-one with a pass over here to KJ. I know you said, you know, when we were discussing this play earlier, that you'd like to see KJ go to his backhand off this pass. But for me, I think he was kind of reaching, and he just wanted to get something on net.
Yeah, possibly there. I mean, I'm, you know, when I see the highest level players, I expect perfection from these guys sometimes. So to me, and when I see KJ going here, I know the momentum's coming his way. So I think if this is an NHL play here, the guy's going to receive that puck as a lefty, pull quick backhand, just flip it right behind. I know his buddy Brock Nelson would have made that play here and went to the backhands. Let's see. You know, tips it on goal. Good save by Taylor again. But again, you know.
Two Mudcat players collide. It's Tiffenworth. Pascali fires one glove, saved by Clay Taylor.
I think Cripps fell asleep a little bit too on that play. He let his man walk right in after the play on the boards on the half wall. But he locked out and no damage was done.
And I love what KJ does here. You know, he just missed that play and he stays in the play here now. And he recognizes a good chance of a turnover here. And I don't know if it's just KJ not wanting to, you know, being a little lazy, not getting back, or just staying there knowing they're going to get that puck. But worked out. They find them. And of course, he returns the favor over to Billy Pascali, and a huge save again by Taylor. But you're right, number seven, Andy Cripps, our buddy, definitely falls asleep on the wall here and allows Pascali to break on him.
Well, it's just eluded him.
Watch it here. So now this great pass here. Is that Matt Gerger, Greg, with the pass?
I think so.
Yeah. So Matt Gerger makes a great pass to KJ. Mudcats are caught again. And watch down here. You can see number seven, Andy Cripps here with Billy Pascali. You're going to watch Billy just recognize, break. And like I tell my kids all the time, it's all about anticipating, right, Greg?
Totally, Tim. Makes a great play.
Mudcat players collide. It's Tiffenworth. Pascali fires one glove, saved by Clay Taylor.
Clay Taylor again. I mean, this game could easily be 4-5 nothing right now.
Yeah, he held him in there early for sure. Again, it's deadly. You know, when you see KJ, Tiefenworth, and Billy Pascali on a 2-on-1, you know, some may think it's an automatic goal half the time. So maybe 3/4 of the time, you know. So great save by Clay there.
Yeah, no, for sure. Okay, so let's follow up here.
Let's follow up with this draw here. Yeah, so here, not sure what Black Ice is doing. There looks like there's two guys back, no one inside helping out, and there's two lone Mudcats just standing there. So easy access for them to shoot out to the points.
Yeah, they should easily in this zone here. There's got to be at least one Black Ice player here.
Yes.
And they have no one here. And there was a player earlier, I don't know if we covered it, where Andy Cripps took a faceoff on the other side. And I wasn't a fan of Andy taking on the other side because he's a lefty. And I like guys going to their backhand on deep faceoffs in the defensive zone, and he lost it. It's a harder faceoff. I mean, I take a lot of faceoffs. I've been a center most of my life. It's hard coming across your body to win a draw against a strong faceoff guy going to his backhand.
Yeah.
He lost it. But this is where I like Andy Cripps. I like him as a lefty in this corner and going against a tough guy on faceoffs, Billy Pascali. And Andy knows that he's got help here now, right? He's got Larry Adegoke over his right shoulder. He's got Will Hines over his left here. He's going to have help. So he doesn't necessarily have to win it clean. He just can't lose it. Get a little piece of it. He knows he's going to have help because, like you said, they're outnumbering Black Ice here. And that's why it's so important to have numbers on a faceoff. So let's play it through.
Yep.
And they come out with it.
Yep. Will Hines takes it.
So this play right here, I think Hines puts
Cripps plays
Cripps in a terrible spot there. There's a guy breathing on Cripps. I think Will should just went to his backhand there and sent it all the way back for a nice little regroup.
I think he got nervous. There's two guys on him, you know, and he sees Cripps, you know, and Cripps, you know how it is, those passes like that, it's twofold. It's wrong. A Cripps will probably go for the puck, and who knows, maybe he's calling for it there, you know. And Hines, but yeah, to your point, again, it's a lot easier where we're sitting now to know just go off the board's backhand and reset it. But Cripps gets pressured here by Black Ice. You know, PJ DiMartino is very aggressive defensively, comes in, knocks it off, and luckily the Mudcats still come away with it.
Yep, let's play this out too, Tim.
Okay.
Adegoke waits there. Doesn't look like he has anything so far, so leaves it there to Will Hines. Hines looking for Adegoke. He's picked up by Coslow coming from behind the net. Hines still has nothing. Hines, now to Cripps.
Did you see the Poulet setup that I sent to you? If everybody were to
rewind that back to him?
I did not.
Yeah.
It would be very interesting.
So a couple things here.
Now to Cripps.
Did you see the Poulet setup that I sent to you?
If all the way back to him?
Rewind further?
Yeah, to the breakout behind the net. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. All right, right here. Yeah, so first, I like how Will Hines, he's going to come back and take that puck from Larry. You know, Will's more of a defensive guy, not as much the goal scorer like Larry. So he takes that puck, realizes, listen, let's get Larry moving. Let's get Larry that puck. So that's a great heads-up play there. Larry on this breakout, watch Larry here turn, facing the puck on the breakout, you know, just being aware of where the puck is. You know, most guys would have their head down, skating forward, not wanting the puck. But Larry makes a nice little breakout here, facing the puck. Obviously, he didn't get the puck on the breakout, but his awareness level was just sky high there. You know, most players wouldn't even turn to look back to give an outlet, to give a pass. But Larry does a great job, and just watch Larry break out there. Just a great play.
And what I love what Andy Cripps does here as well is he cuts back low, so he supports a D-man because he's black ice is pressuring behind the net.
Yeah.
And then watch this pass he makes. He makes a soft pass off the boards to Larry that just misses. And as Larry receives this puck, it's a two-on-one the other way. It's just a gorgeous pass by Cripps. Let's watch it.
Yep.
Little subtle one. Boom. Could have been a two-on-one. I think CJ thought Larry was getting it. Larry might have thought CJ was getting that one, and then no one did. But that could have easily been a two-on-one in, and who knows what happens there.
No, totally. Could have been so a two-on-one.
Great play all around by the Mudcats. All right, let's forward here.
Turnbull will race after it. Behind the net. Fired on, and Machinsky makes the save.
Another great.
Here's a great play, Greg, on a couple situations. I'm going to talk first about what the Mudcats did well here, and then you're going to jump in on what black guys didn't do so well here. So, you know, Travis Turnbull, who's one of my favorite players in the game, he uses his body here, and I love how he comes in and he's using what God gave him. He's got strength, right? So he throws the puck to an area and goes and gets it. No one's knocking him off the puck. And then he finds an open man in front as opposed to trying to stick handle around here and probably get knocked off the puck. The puck off his stick. So let's watch Travis here, what he does here with this puck. So he comes in. See how he threw it there, Greg?
Yep.
That again. Right here. See how he throws the puck to this space? Right there. He throws it knowing, all right, I got Matt Gerger on me who I'm going to throw down if he comes at me. But I know Matt Gerger can knock the puck off my stick, but he's not knocking me off the puck. Or it's going to be a penalty if he hits him, right? He doesn't have the puck anymore. So he throws it to this area, and then he finds an open man in front. And now Chinny, who's been relatively quiet to this point, hasn't had to make nearly the saves that Clay Tail has, which is difficult for a goalie to be basically reading a newspaper for the last 10 minutes. And now suddenly got to make a tough save to Chinny's credit. And as we know, he's a gamer, makes a big save here. Let's watch this play by Travis, though. And this is a great save on Huntbringer, who winds up being a big part of this game, who's the newest member, Michael Huntbringer from Missouri, who's Division I hockey player, played American Hockey League, big-time player that the Missouri, from Missouri, that I'm assuming Turnbull has some connection with him. They picked up this year, the Mudcats, and wound up being their leading scorer with 6 points in the round robin. But great play by Turnbull here. But let's talk about the defense by Black Ice.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, who would have thought a play would have happened, with Travis there on the short side. You know, everyone thought he was probably going to go around the net, give everyone an extra second maybe to regroup and get a man. But he definitely catches Nate Gerger sleeping a little bit. And Nate's got that big stick, long reach. You know what? Put the stick down, Nate. You know, put it in the passing lane, put it in defensive zone lane, and nothing happens. But just a great play by Travis, you know.
Are you assuming here, Greg? Are you assuming Cal Kafouk here? He's got him, right? He's got 55.
Yeah.
And then Nate's got to be, he's got to be worrying about 19 here, right? Would you say, is that fair?
Yeah. And again, you know, Nate probably fell asleep thinking that Travis was either going to get, you know, a puck off his stick there, or he's going to go behind the net. But he made a great play and caught him sleeping a little bit.
Okay. Yeah. No, that definitely happens a lot in games for sure. Now, you know, one of the youngest players on Mudcats, and I love seeing it, was, you know, the Mudcats definitely, Greg, to me, this was the best Mudcats team I've seen in years. Yeah. And, you know, way back in the day, they were the team to reckon with. And, you know, like every team, they got older and it's about rebuilding, right? And they, this year, I thought, brought the deepest team that they've brought in a long time to the PAMA Pro Division. And Ty Hutch, Murchison, who's Ken Murchison, who was the assistant coach with Chad Siebel here for the Mudcats. It was great seeing them. It worked out with his schedule with ice hockey. He's playing in Michigan with ice on hold. He was able to come play. He's a 93, I believe.
You know, he's on the development team.
What's that?
He's on the development team.
Right. Excuse me, 03. He's an 03. So he's 17 years old. Great ice player. He's been playing roller his whole life. Dad used to own the Corona rink. So, you know, he's been on his wheels forever as a Bulldog. But here's just a little bit of example, I think, of, you know, that youth a little bit. With a turnover, and it's a great play by Black Ice knocking a puck out of the air, but I think it just shows a little bit of a nonchalant play by Murchison thinking, you know, at his age group, this play doesn't happen too often defensively, and then about picking up a man on the way back. So let's roll it through here.
Turnbull.
Here's Murch, number five.
Up top now, Ty Murchison again. Shots 8-2.
So see that little play right there?
Yep.
I think that's Tyler Kraft makes a great, and this is why I love Tyler, just a great two-way player. Knocks the puck here, little
shot,
nonchalant play back, Tyler out of the air, and now they're off for the races. And this is when I want to see Murch find the late man here, Greg, on this 3-on-2. They got lucky they didn't score on him here, but yeah. Instead he went to the puck carrier where there already was a man on D on that man, and they found the open man in front. So definitely a lack of communication a little bit on defending the 3-on-2. Yeah, let's play it through and then we can talk about it.
Right now, not many shots, all neutrals on play. Taken away by Kraft. Nate Gerger. Gerger fires over top of the net.
And he missed a net. Let's watch the back check here, Greg. So I like to see Murch here go and pick up Nate Gerger here, 92, on this play, knowing that this man is being covered here by, I think it's Turnbull, okay? And we double up on the puck, and a great play by Kraft again finds the open man Gerger, and I think Black Ice played this 3-on-2 almost to perfection, except maybe I like to see the man here go harder to the net a little bit and open up a lane like Pat Maroon did the other night in the Stanley Cup. But great play here. There he goes. And missed the net.
Yeah. No, totally. And it looked like Travis Turnbull was trying to communicate there, and he was pointing over to the late guy. Yeah, it's a numbers game there, and he has to realize that you know, he has to go to that closest guy there. And that's the third guy trailing.
Now, Greg, with this next play here, I want you to talk a little bit about as a defender, how tough it is to cover a guy or guard a guy like Larry Adegoke. You know, Larry is a big, strong man, arguably the most fit, strongest guy in the pro division. I would make an argument. I mean, he's a strength and conditioning coach for AAA, AA New York Yankees. Not on his skates as much as he normally is, but this year he's got on his skates a lot more with the baseball minor league season being canceled. He was able to come out and not only play, but work with us, which was great. He was an unbelievable guy to have on the staff. But he has that strength dynamic, and he's so skilled, Greg. So that's a deadly combo. And I want to let's watch this play he makes here, which for a big man, it's such a tough play. And it's got to be a hard one to defend. So after he makes it, I want you to talk a little bit as a defender about this play.
Nothing Black Ice. Up to DiMartino, poked away by Andy Cripps. DiMartino in the corner. Walks it out. Cripps checks him, and Cripps takes the puck back in behind the net. Barron and DiMartino do battle. Sent up to Larry Adegoke. Adegoke cuts to the middle. Larry Adegoke on his backhand, saved by Machinsky.
let's watch that play again here. This little spin, little subtle move by Larry, but it winds up being a really tough save for Chinny because he's got to assume Larry's cutting here to shoot the puck. And then he throws that backhand. So just talk a little bit about how tough it is to defend the guy with size like that, Greg.
Yeah, I couldn't tell who the defenseman was there, Tim, but it seemed like he kind of got caught, you know, kind of backward skating, forward skating, just kind of caught in the middle there. But he did force into his backhand, which you want to do, right, on a play like that. And it's just a great shot by Larry because it kind of throws everyone off. It throws the goalie off because the goalie has no idea where the puck's coming from. And the defenseman, you know, he doesn't really know where the puck's coming to, and he's such a long, big guy that you can't get to him. You can't get to the shooting lane because he's just so big.
And remember, when you take hitting out of a game, Greg, and not that anyone wants to really be hitting Larry Adegoki, but when the hitting aspect is taken out, your hands are kind of tied as a defender when you're going against a big, strong guy. That's why Pat Maroon was always so hard to defend playing roller hockey, right? Yeah. When you get a big man, you can't stop him using your body as a penalty, so then you wind up grabbing a guy like that, and it's so hard to defend. So when you get a guy like him, that's why Jack Combs also on the Snipers is a tough guy to defend because they're big, strong, and they have the hands, and that's a deadly combo in roller hockey for sure.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it's just a great play by Larry.
So we're going to fast forward here, Greg, to a play. I'm going to let you jump in here on this play here, and let's listen to George Brown and Dennis Jelcic.
And play is stopped as it's covered up by Machinsky.
Shocker. Another face-off we're going to talk about here, GT.
Wow.
All right. Pause it here, Tim.
Yep.
So here, again, I don't like that fourth guy, the defenseman, Kozlo. I don't like him in that corner there because there's no one shooting out to the point. All right, I think he's got to line up inside, let a forward shoot out to the point. CJ Yoder out there.
So you don't like Kozlo back here?
I personally don't. I'd rather him move up to the inside next to PJ DiMartino there.
Up here.
Yeah, I don't know who's shooting out. I like a D-man on the far boards where KJ is, but he is a lefty over there. You know, every team's different. Every team, you know, is different. So. But I like Kaz in the inside there, just because it gives an extra guy to shoot out to the point. You got to figure, I think that is Merchantson over there with KJ. So he's blocking him to shoot out. So everyone's on a man there, right? Everyone's tying up. So a puck is won by Black Ice here into a corner. KJ Tiefenworth should get that puck, you know, because he should be the first guy there. He should win every 50-50 puck on the corner, and he should win the pucks all the way back to the corner. So I'd like to see Kozlo up in the middle and have a guy shooting out to the point, man.
Yeah, so talking about both sides of this, you know, what's the pros and cons of everything? You know, if the Mudcats are thinking here, hey, we want to win this draw and get the puck to CJ Yoder, right, for a shot. But then again, you look at the faceoff man for Mudcats, he looks like a lefty going on his backhand there. So that puck's probably not going to get to CJ right away, right?
True.
If it was a righty, then you're thinking, all right, he's trying to win this back. But right now, this puck's probably, if they win, it's going to go to this board. Black Ice is thinking the defensive side of this, I guess. They want to just control the puck without pressure, and they feel that Billy Pascali is their number one faceoff guy. He's going to win this draw. But like you said, you know, there's a lot of risk and reward here. If this puck winds up on CJ's stick, he's got a lot of time. I mean, lucky for them, CJ doesn't like to shoot the puck anyway half the time, so he probably wouldn't there. But to your point, Kozlo's kind of, you know, way back here. So it's really that philosophy. I think everyone's a little different how they want to handle it. So I don't have a huge problem with this draw, but I definitely 100% see where you're coming from on having a guy up here to shoot out to the point.
I just think it's a waste of a guy. You know, KJ's already doing his job if the puck's won back, you know. It's just, yeah, he's just an extra guy doing nothing. It's kind of like an ice hockey. It's like an ice hockey draw there, you know, line up like they have five guys. But it worked out for Black Ice.
Yeah, Scully walks in. That one's off.
Sorry there, Greg.
No, it worked out overall. You know, they did get a 2-on-1 out of the deal. But Clay came up big again.
I love this play by CJ Yoder here. Now, one thing, Greg, we could talk all day about things I get mad at, and you know, but well, better than anyone, and so does PJ Kavaya. The one thing I get mad at more than anything is when guys leave their feet on defense. I just don't believe in it. And we could, that's a whole podcast we could talk about. I know you don't always agree with me on that. But here's a great play by CJ Yoder, who's, let's face it, at 44 years old, not the fastest anymore. He's got the brains. I love how he uses his reach, he uses his size. He plays it right. He stays on his feet. He forces it. He cheats over knowing where the play is going, knowing that Billy Pascali's probably not really going to shoot the puck here. He's more of a passer looking for PJ. So let's just watch this play by CJ Yoder on defense.
That's Pascali and DiMartino. Pascali walks in. That one's off a skate.
And it goes off him and goes on net, but it's a great play by CJ there. Let's watch it one more time because, you know, CJ known a lot for his offensive game, but of course, as you know, is a great defensive player too. Makes a great read there. And again, 2-on-1 black ice. They score there. They're up 3-0 again. And defense, CJ and Clay Taylor with a big save, which is not easy off your own defender.
Yeah. Black ice had so many opportunities to go up by, you know, 3 or 4 goals. And black and the Mudcats came away with some great defensive plays and some great goaltending. So, you know, they kept them in the game.
And we know usually in roller hockey, an odd man break one way turns into an odd man break the other way. And that happened a lot in this game. Seemed like both teams were a little loosey-goosey at times on that. And Here's a play the other way for the Mudcats where Ty Murchison winds up with the puck and he's got Travis Turnbull with him. And I feel that he waited a little too long to try to make a pass here. And I'm sure Turnbull let him know it on the bench, but I know Travis. But to me, you got to get this puck to Travis Turnbull sooner for a wide open shot on a 2-on-1. So let's watch it through here.
One's off a skate. Broken up by CJ Yoder. Who else? 2-on-1. Up on the wing, and now the Mudcats start away. Murchison with Turnbull. Murchison try to get at the Turnbull.
I'm going to rewind a little bit further. A play I just realized there. What I like too here, Greg, is watch Clay Taylor here. So he's got pressure here, Greg, and this easily could have been a face-off deep in their zone. And watch what Clay does.
That one's off a skate.
One that a little bit more.
Golly walks in.
So Billy probably should have stopped hard on the goal there, doesn't he?
It's off a Clay. Skate. Broken up by CJ Yoder. Who else? 2-on-1.
And then it's
up on the wing,
and
now the Mudcats start away. Murchison.
So right here is where I'd like to see Ty look to move that puck to him.
Yeah.
You know, Travis is the shooter. He's their best goal scorer. They're down by 2. He's got this lane here. And the further you take it, as you know, Greg, that window gets smaller and smaller, right?
Yeah.
And that's what happens here on Murchison. Again, first time playing the Pro Division. The game's going faster. I'm sure – you know, in most divisions, he'd easily make this play, but great play by Kozlo here.
Turnbull, Murchison try to get at the Turnbull, broken up by the defense by Kozlo.
And they break it up, and nothing comes out of that 2-on-1.
Yep. Guess we can keep playing it to 2029.
Set up on the wing, and another 2-on-1 back the other way. DiMartino, but a great back check by Turnbull. DiMartino gets around 1, cleared it in front, rolls on Clay Taylor. Taylor wants to play it, and does. It's CJ Yoder to Murchison. Is Huntington claims a stick. Tried to play it through to Ty Murchison, but broken up, and Black Eye starts away again. It's Tiffenworth. Tiffenworth stops, gets it to DiMartino. DiMartino takes a look. All 4 Mudcats in the zone. Sent back to Pascali. Pascali got it to Kafuk. Kafuk curls around.
I know this play here is with Cal Kafuk, Greg. You had talked about this. So let's rewind a little bit for Cal here. You want to talk about it before we show it here again?
Yeah, so Cal makes a great play overall. I mean, I think he could have walked it in and got a shot on net. He made the smart play under 2 minutes left, up by 2. You know, nothing against here. Send it back, control the puck. But I definitely would have liked to see him maybe walk in because I think he had more room than he thought. And he could have walked it in on his forehand. So once he's come around the net, he does send it back. Makes a smart play. Don't get me wrong. I probably would have done the same thing. But I think he had a little more time and room than he thought.
Yeah, so let's watch it through here. So look like Cal here. Let's watch him. He comes around the net right here. He could have probably turned back and went to the goal because the Mudcats, no one pressured him. But he didn't realize he had no pressure, right? And then went back with the puck.
Yeah.
Right there, all that room.
He could have stopped. He could have walked in on his forehand, could have walked in on his backhand, got a shot on net. I think obviously if it was late in the game, down by a goal, he definitely would have. But he did make a smart play, sent it back, and, you know, time's on their side.
Correct. No, made a great play there. So here we're getting towards the end of the half here. And let's just talk this last play here with Nate Gerger. So period's coming to an end. Nate Gerger gets a chance one-on-one. And, you know, Nate's not necessarily known as that guy that's going to slice and dice you with the puck. He's more of a shooter in my eyes. So here we got Nate with a last chance here.
And Anagoki wants to start away. Anagoki, bad turnover there.
Here we go.
And it's Nate Gerger. Gerger walking it through on backhand, forehand.
So, Greg, I know you and I were in agreement here that we'd like to see Nate just walk in here, back the defender up, and just fire one on goal and go hard to the net, right? Especially with, I think, just about 30 seconds left in the period.
Yeah, but let's talk about his read before that with that long stick of his. You know, he picked off that pass, read that play as it was developing, made an awesome play defensively.
Jumped it.
Yeah. That, and look at Skyler. Look at Skyler Hoare, the defenseman. He's already at the circles. You know, if Nate's getting around him, it's going to be really tight to get around defenseman and the goalie at that point. And Nate could shoot the puck. And a goalie's worst nightmare is a shot to his screen. And I definitely think late in the period, you know, get a shot on net through a screen, you know, and a whistle.
And Skyler Hoare, I think, was definitely put in a tough spot here, Greg, as you've been many times by your forwards. Totally. He might have been going for a line change for all we know. You know, the play's going the other way. Larry has it easy. It's an easy play. Period's winding down because let's rewind a little bit. So watch Skyler here. He's up here. Who knows what he might be going for a line change. Larry makes that bad pass, and then boom, whoop, I got to get back now. Oh, and now there's all that gap, right?
Yeah.
And as a defender, you don't want all that gap, but he was put in a tough spot here. So good play by Skyler, though, to at least as Nate got in to play the body and just knock him off the puck. Great play.
Yep, made a great play. Made up for the gap there.
Yeah, so there we got the end of the first half there, and it is 2-1. Still, it's 2-0 still, Black Ice.
This is Phil Maroon, coach of the Mars Blade Lions. Okay, and I guess, yeah, I'm the brother of Pat Maroon, Stanley Cup champion, back-to-back Stanley Cup finalist. Are you listening to the State Wars Hockey Podcast? Because I know I am. Let's go Bolts, baby.
So we heard it there from our buddy Phil Maroon. I think he's got to update that, Greg, now to say two-time Stanley Cup champion, my brother, Pat Maroon.
Yeah, we got to get him to send over some new audio.
Definitely a character in the sport there. I know Pete Penicky mentioned that. Phil Maroon, brother of Pat Maroon. And let's not forget Justin Maroon. But Phil Maroon took over the coaching duties last year for Joe Cook for the Alkali Rebel Lions. And now the newly named Mars Blade Lions. And we'll talk more about that on a future podcast with Phil and maybe Joe Cook as well about Mars Blade and their sponsorship there with that team. But I'm assuming Phil Maroon will be a coach for a while with that team, whether in conjunction with Joe Cook or if Joe's stepping back, I'm not sure yet. But Phil did a great job with that team last year, Greg.
Yeah, he did. You know, they had a slow start, but they got better and better. And, you know more than I do, just as much as I do, that Phil takes so much pride in it. He's really into it and loves coaching, loves the sport, and just loves being involved. You want to play that Car Shield video, Tim?
Yeah, I think this is just fitting now that we show this. And there's actually two members of State Wars players in this video here that we'll talk about. You got Pat Maroon, obviously everyone knows, but then our friend Sarah Beer riding the Zamboni as well in this video, filmed in California. But thank you to our big sponsor, Car Shield, for Car Shield TV of the PAMA Pro Division. Let's play out this commercial here.
Call the team I trust at Car Shield. You'll never have to pay for cover repairs again. They've helped millions of drivers save on expensive car repairs, and Car Shield covers most vehicles. I said most.
There he is, Pat Maroon. I feel like I see him everywhere now in the Car Shield commercial. So here, we're going to fast forward here, Greg, to in the second half. It's still 2-0. And, you know, part of the theme in the second half of Black Ice is going to be bad penalties, which is not normal for them. And we talked earlier about Derek Schultz, about the kind of player he is, and he scored a big goal early in this game. And here he is you know, there was a play earlier we didn't cover it where Larry Adegoke kind of shoved down one of the Black Ice players, and he might have got away with one. We're not sure. You know, he's kind of a big, strong guy, and he plays on the edge for sure. And I know George Brown and Dennis Jelcic talked about him playing on that line. And really, depending on who the referees are, Greg, you know, sometimes some refs let that go, some don't. It's the luck of the draw. But yeah. Larry, you know, he throws the body around, uses stick a little bit. He's strong, and you definitely feel it when he hits you. So he hit one of the players earlier, and he had Derek Schultz. Takes kind of a dumb penalty, and you know he threw him pretty hard to throw Larry down, and gives a power play to Mudcats and gives him some life. And maybe it was just a payback for what he felt that his teammate did to him earlier. He did to his teammate earlier, but let's watch this play here with Schultze.
Has some youth games going on, 02s and 04s, but you don't see the normal hang out, watch some games.
Yeah.
Do some, you know, picture viewing, et cetera.
Adegoke's taken out, and there's a...
So that play, Greg, it's hard to see from the angle, and I remember watching this game. I was on the other side. That actually might be me right here with Brian watching the game in our masks. But he gets thrown awkwardly into the boards, and it was kind of a dangerous play, and he kind of grabs his arm, and Larry's kind of stiff-arming him here, shielding him off with his strength, and Derek just keeps going, and the puck's out of there, picture. And just... Viewing, throws him down.
Adegoke's taken out, and there's a penalty coming up now to Black Ice.
Now, to this point, Greg, we talk about momentum in hockey. I feel that Black Ice has controlled and owned this game.
Yeah.
They're up by two. They should be up by four or five. If I'm Jay Muir, Aaron Weiss at halftime, I'm telling my guys, just bury our chances. We could mercy these guys already. Like, we're dominating the game. Yeah, they've had some chances, but, you know, we didn't score on our power play, which we're money on. And we're not burying our two-on-ones, which we're money on. Is unfortunately, as snipers, we know too much that they always bury their two-on-ones on us. But it's 2-0. They let the Mudcats hang around and hear a bad penalty. Now it's a power play, and this is huge because there's so much time left in this game as we talk about how long these games are. You have 18 minutes, 17 minutes left, and now you get a power play. You need to stop here, right?
Totally. Yeah, Derek, you know, I think he – got tied up with Larry, and then he just kind of gave the extra shove into the boards. Like you said, it's just hard from that angle. You know, Larry's a big guy, so for him to go down like that, it was probably a penalty.
Now, here's an example with this power play, Greg. We talked about earlier in a box. Guys are doing a lot of boxes, it seems, and they're going low to high, and then they find that cross pass. And Black Ice knows they're looking for Turnbull, right? Lower Barron's not a huge threat as a shooter. He's a good passer. He's got that sneaky wrister. He's a great skater, but I wouldn't look at him as a shooter up there. Turnbull's the guy. They're cheating over to him a little bit, but by going low to high, it kind of moves everyone around a little bit. And Turnbull here, who's one of the best shooters in the game, just does what he does best.
So here's the Mudcat power play. Of course, Turnbull on the left side, Barron at the point. In front is the eighth wonder of roller hockey, CJ Oder. Barron, Turnbull. They're cheating the Turnbull's side. Gerger is there because they know Turnbull wants to shoot. Come for Huntington. Huntington, Turnbull. Turnbull, fire, scores!
That's a snipe, Greg.
Yeah, that's a goal scorer's goal right there. And, you know, we've seen it quite often, time and time again. Travis Turnbull up top there with a absolute rocket. Yeah, Nate Gerger, you know, they're doing a great job in the beginning. Then Nate, I think, kind of got caught down low, and he didn't shoot out quick enough and get that stick in the shooting lane, and Travis Turnbull took full advantage of that.
Yeah, and you can see here, Greg, how Black Ice is doing a great job high here, and they're taking away. Even though you look Turnbull, he's got Humbringer down low here for a quick pass, but it, you know, it'd be tough.
Yeah.
But they're working it up top, and then you get the puck down low and then high again, and it opens it up. And here's a perfect example of it. There's not a lot of room here, and Black Ice is doing a great job, but then it goes low.
Yeah.
And here again now. Now you got a man dropping down a little bit, which again, I'm not a big fan of. And then Nate's a little slow here. So he's worried about this man here down low. He's worried about CJ. So he's going to rush there. And two men are all going to the same puck. So again, we talked about puck focused earlier. So let's talk about puck focused again. His eyes are on the puck. His eyes are on the puck. It's okay. You always want to look at the puck carrier, but their body momentum is pulling them in the same direction, and it causes, I think, an easy opening of a lane here. And let's watch it through. And then the snipe. And then Chinny's got no chance on that.
Yeah, none. Looked like Nate tried blocking it with his, you know, his leg, his foot. But he's got to get a stick out to him, and I'm sure he knows that after the goal was scored.
Yeah, I mean, and being I've blown Nate most of this game, I want to pick on him a little bit here. You know, it's this is my problem with his play here is he is 6 foot whatever. He's got a 20-foot long stick, and he doesn't use his stick at all to get out there and block a puck and stick on puck, as we know. He just kind of holds his stick back. Let's watch his stick positioning here. So right away, if I'm coaching a kid here, I want to see that stick out already. You know, and he's getting here. And now his stick's back behind his body, and he's giving all that room to Turnbull. And trust me, Turnbull's a goal scorer. He sees that. If that stick's out, he may not shoot that because he knows it might be deflected out into the crowd. But still, there's a stick. It's still behind him. And then he makes the play here, which is lucky Turnbull didn't hit him in the foot. He might have been out for the tournament. He just lifts his foot up there to block it and doesn't use a stick at all. So I think Nate Gerger, if he went back and watched this tape, he would go back saying, hey, I got to get out there with my stick, especially when I see it's Travis Turnbull. But great shot by Travis to make this a 2-1 lead and cut it in half.
Yeah, it's crazy. You know, obviously the power play was working for the Mudcats, and I wouldn't have changed anything, but it's weird not seeing Larry up there in the power play. You know, Larry Adegoki's got a great shot. He's got a rifle from the top. But Lauren's a great playmaker. He could score goals, and he's a defenseman, right? There's no other defenseman up top. So just in case there was an odd man rush, he's back there.
Oh, for sure. I'm going to watch this play here, Greg. And what I love about this play is right after the power play. Now, Mudcats, I feel like, are going to start taking it to them a little bit. They sense it a little bit. They got some momentum. And I love this play here by Lauren Barron. You know, Ethan Frank, we haven't called his name yet in this game. Young player, great player. His dad, Dave Frank, is our Nebraska coordinator out in that area. Owns one of the skate cities out there. Ethan's been on his skates his whole life, played in the USHL. Now he's playing, I think, Division I hockey. I think he's playing for Omaha, Nebraska, if I'm not mistaken, Greg. And I love what he does here. And here's Ethan here, just so the fans at home can see this. This is Ethan. And I love how he's going to circle back and get himself going. And Lauren Barron recognizes that this kid's got speed, and he's just going to give a little area pass. And Ethan's going to go get it, and he's going to attack KJ Tiffenworth, who's, you know, as great as KJ is, speed is not really what he's known for. And Ethan just takes him and makes a great play and a big save by Chinny. But let's just watch this play.
That's good for us, though.
Right here.
We like that.
Boom.
Sent across. Here's another chance. In on goal. Backhand stopped by much.
Let's watch this one more time. And I want everyone at home to watch Lauren. So as puck's coming to Lauren Barron, and we talk to kids all the time about knowing what you want to do with the puck before you get it, not after you get it. And I love it, Lauren here. And I'm going to try to slow it down a little bit right here. See already, Greg? See where his head is? Yeah. He's already looking towards Ethan. And see where the puck is? It's not even on a stick yet. He's already looking up at this play. And that's a pro play by Lauren Barron. He's looking at the play. He already knows. He's not receiving it, because if he receives that puck, Greg, turns with it and then thinks about it, this guy's in his face. The play never would have happened. Yep. He's got his head up. He's already looking. Head on a swivel, we talk about. Makes a great place, an area pass to Ethan. Watch it. Settles it now. Gives it to him. Black ice is caught. And just a great play here and a great save and a big save by Chinny.
Yeah, that's a huge save there. And good heads up play by Lauren. I mean, that's an awesome read. And great speed by Ethan Frank.
Great speed for sure. All right, let's fast forward here a little bit. We got a nice defensive play here by Cody Bobey, who, you know, on that team, he's known more for his defensive game. He's not the most offensive player on that team. And I like this play here, Greg, that he makes. I'll let you talk about as a defender, just this play by Bobey here as it comes through.
Eight furthers it along for Larry Adegoki. Page wants to come down the side, defended by Kafuk. Help there by Tyler Kraft and broken up.
Great Gerger pass.
Gets it up ahead. They have a 3-on-1 if they hurry. It's a 2-on-1 up ahead, and here's Kafuk. Kafuk in, tried to get it across.
Talk about that play there, Greg, by Bovey, reading that play, because that was dangerous there. And if they score there, then the game might be in trouble again.
Yeah, no, Bovey made the great play, went to the back door, gave the goalie the shot on the forehand. you know, would have been a snipe. You know, he would have had to snipe that goal to Barry. So put that on the goalie, right? And, you know, Ethan made a great play going to the middle and blocking that passing lane.
Yeah, definitely love that play there. Let's force, we're going to go to here one involving Sky Lahore. Okay, here's a play, Greg. Now, you and I talked about this at length the other day. I like what Skylar's thinking here, but let's let it play through first, and we'll talk about it.
Energy, huh? They want some screaming on the broadcast? We're very professional here. Yeah.
So I'll tell you to calm it down there. Broken up by.
I want you to talk about that play a little bit, Greg.
Yeah, not sure who that was trying to make the pass there, Tim.
Skylar.
Oh, it was Skylar. I'm sorry. Yeah, so Skylar makes a great heads up play. Obviously, defenseman there, was it Nate, Matt Gerger, knows that pass is coming, you know, towards the middle. I like to see Skylar put that in the air, maybe on net, you know, off a pad for the guy cutting in, or, you know, a nice little sauce pass, but he's got to get that on net maybe for a rebound there.
Yeah, I think if Skylar throws a hard one at the pads, there's a good chance it could bounce off Chinny, and then you got a guy with a step that's humpering or going to the net. Mm-hmm. Because getting that to him on the tape is probably not going to have happen, and Gerger makes a great read. And you can just see where Gerger stole it, that, you know, Skylar was pretty much off the mark anyway with that pass by the time it never would have gotten through anyway. So, yeah, you know, if you're going to make a play there, let's not force it, throw it on goal, and good things happen, right? Shoot for rebounds, Greg.
Yeah, shoot for rebounds. You know, a lot of players, especially youth players, don't do that enough, you know. Get pucks on net, especially a shot like that. Nice, low, hard shot on net off the pads for a rebound. But that led to a goal. Great read by Matt Gerger there. And Black Ice goes up 3-1.
Yeah, you know, we've mentioned Cal Kafuk's name a few times this broadcast. And this is a great individual effort by Kafuk here. And let's play this one through.
Black Ice has it. Adegoke wanted to get to Gerger beforehand. Gerger holds a stick, but Adegoke regained the puck, and now it's in behind the net for Andy Cripps. Gerger tried to broke that up, and it's taken away by Kafuk. Kafuk steps in, fires one. Taylor makes a save. Rebound! Stopped by Taylor.
Yeah, just a great individual effort by Cal. You know, getting that shot through the screen like we talked about with Della Morte last week. Got that shot on net and followed it up with a rebound.
And I love right here, Greg. So when the play starts in the corner, so Big Larry's got the puck in the corner. He makes a nice little backhand pass off the boards to Bobby going back. But I love Cal here. Like you see Cal, he doesn't just stand there and just wait. As soon as that play is going to happen, again, just shows his hockey IQ. He reads it. He breaks on Bobby and forces a play. And it's a tough bounce off the boards. And then he puts Bobby's in a tough position. And then Cal just outworks him. You know, one-on-one, out-muscles him for a puck. And let's watch it here a little bit. So that puck there, he bounces off him, and now there's a little battle. He pulls on, he battles through it. Now here, this great play he makes here. Now he creates some space for himself, right, Greg? That yep. Little pullback. And yep. He turns, who's number 22 there on the Mudcats?
I think it might be Cody Page.
Cody Page. He makes Cody Page turn in a bad spot now. Now Cody's way out of position here. And Kafuk gets a shot off. And what I love what Kafuk does here, Greg, it kind of reminds me a little bit of Braden Point's goal the other night, first goal in the game 6 of the Stanley Cup. The only difference was Point's a righty and it went back to his forehand. But yeah. Cal makes a shot here. And just like Point did, he goes hard to the net, doesn't stop his feet, gets his own rebound, even though he doesn't have numbers, and makes Clay Taylor have to make not one but two great saves here. See how he follows it? Boom. Second yep. Save. Great saves by Taylor.
Yeah, and Bobby made a great play of going to the point. I'm sorry, the trailer to the second guy. You know, he left his man when he knew that Page was there, and he went to the trailer. So it was a good play by him.
Definitely. Great play all around there. Now, being we've talked so much about all these great plays Kafuk is making, let's talk about here a little bit of a pretty dumb play that he makes here. And to me, this is when we talk about John Chabot not being there and Kafuk being there. You know, Kafuk filled his skates big time on the scoring sheet. But this play now, when you have a player like Kafuk, and it's you take the good with the bad, he plays on an edge, right, Greg? So he's in your face. He made that play on Bovey. He's got that strength. He uses his body well. He's tough as nails. He's a little cheap at times with his stick, gets in there, and he plays that on-the-edge game, which you want. But then a play like this can happen where he does a little too much, steps over the edge. And if I'm Jay Muro, and I haven't seen Schultz on the rink much after his dumb penalty early. I don't know how quick Jay Muro throws Kafuk back out on the rink after this penalty. But here they are, you know, black ice at this point. You know, these guys, you know, you guys were up. Actually, I think we missed the last goal. We're going to have to rewind it in a second after we go over this. Black ice is actually up 3-1 here.
Yeah, and it was off that Nate Gerger play defensively on Skyler. They went down and scored.
Okay, yeah, so they scored, went up 3-1. But now Kafuk, black ice has all the momentum in the world here, Greg, right now. So I am sure if you're a coach or captain of this team, you can't be happy with this play by Cal here. So yeah. Cody Page and him are getting at it a little bit in front. And as we both know, Cody Page is kind of that agitator. He's that guy that gets on your nerves. That's kind of his role out there. He's kind of like that, how Brandon Marchand used to be and stuff, just in your face kind of guy, annoy you or whatever. So he's pushing, gives Cal a little shove, but Cal just takes it a little too far, and the referee's right there and has to call it.
Yeah.
From the air, grabbed and broken up one more time by Kraft. Kraft and Bovee do battle.
So let's watch what Page did first. So Page, let's watch them in front here. Page gives him a little shove.
Kraft and Bovee.
Boom, not much there. And then watch Cal and watch where the referee is.
Bovee after Kraft. Bovee still defending Kraft. Kafuk.
And just an easy penalty, right, Greg? Dumb penalty.
It's an easy one there. Dumb penalty. I'm sure he knows it too. I mean, he's had such a good game. You know, he battles hard. Definitely shouldn't have hit him that hard. Should have gave him maybe a little shove, but he definitely crossed the line there.
Yeah, you know, sometimes with guys, you take the good with the bad. Cal is such a great player. You know what he's going to bring offensively and stuff. And, you know, some guys, again, like we talked about, we have guys on our team we know like that that just take those penalties sometimes. You shake your head, but it's kind of what makes him so great on the offensive side with that sandpaper they bring, but take the good with the bad. So let's watch this power play. Once again here, the Mudcats down by two on the power play. Have a chance now to get within one again on the power play, thanks to a bad penalty by Black Ice. And we're going to watch the GOAT here, CJ Yoder, at the end of this power play with a big goal.
Yoder's taken out of the play. Gerger furthers it along, but it's Turnbull getting it from Barron. Turnbull. Barron.
15 seconds left.
Barron walks it in to Turnbull. Turnbull.
10 seconds.
Switches. Huntington looking back. And that's a play that I don't know what his intention was there.
I don't like that at all. But it's a bad turnover. Yeah.
Barron takes it. Barron risks that one. Tip by Yoder. Scores! Right in front of that. Just what we talked about.
This happens to get to him somehow.
And CJ Yoder has found a new home in front of that.
Two bad penalties. Two power play goals.
And the power play had ended, but
Still, action from the power play. Listen up, folks. Home, kids.
Absolutely.
Don't take the bad penalty. If you're coming here in the next 7 days, don't be that guy or that girl.
Absolutely.
How's that, Saul? Is that a little more action for you?
Great play. Great play with Lauren Barron there.
Waiting for this replay here.
Off the rebound and pumps it.
So CJ deflects it down and then turns and uses his body in front. So, Greg, you played with CJ many years on Team USA. Back then, I'm gonna go out on a limb and say I don't think CJ was that guy in front of the goal on the power play. You know, at every power play, you want to see him with the puck on his stick a little bit more. But he's really embraced that role down low. And I know you sometimes like being that guy down low as well. But CJ just, you know, having the hands and the brains, and he's got decent size, CJ. You know, I joked with him yesterday. He's gotten a little heftier over the years as well. But he's got the height, the reach. He's a stronger guy as an older guy now. And the front of the net seems like a perfect home for him.
Yeah, believe it or not, he's been down low quite often. You know, even back in the day, he was down low a lot. He's just great around the net. He's got great hands, great vision, and he deflects so many pucks. He's great with his stick down there. I've seen so many deflection goals, you know, tip-ins, stuff like that from CJ. So, you know, quite often I do see him down there quite a bit. You know, obviously he doesn't have that heavy shot from the top. He does play a smart role up there, but usually he's down low. He is down low quite often, and he makes a great play. He knows where the puck's going, and can't teach it. Smart.
Hey, guys. CJ Yoder here, captain of the Tour Mudcats. When I'm not bathing in the fountain of youth in my backyard, I'm listening to State Worst Podcast. You guys should be, too.
There you go, Steve.
Yoder. You know, it's funny, Greg, you know, on that play, you know, give kudos to Lauren Barron, because sometimes the right play, just throw the puck to the net. You know, it was the end of the power play. I think Dennis Jelcic had mentioned the power play had just ended. Just throwing one on goal, simple play. You know, it wasn't a snipe. It wasn't a tap-in backdoor play. It was just a throw on net, man in front. And sometimes we forget, just get pucks to the net. You know, it could be frustrating as a coach and as a player sometimes. The guys just aren't getting pucks to the net on the power play especially. But there you have that. And now – Jay Muro's got to be frustrated. You know, I know how loud Jay is and how he gets. And knowing now this game is 3-2. They had a tough game earlier in the day against Liberty, which they won in a shootout, I believe, or by a goal. And now here it is. You're playing the Mudcats. You're up 3-2 now. The only reason Mudcats are in the game are two reasons. Clay Taylor and dumb penalties for two power play goals by the Mudcats. So you got to be all over you guys. Now, guys, stay out of the box and we win this game.
Yeah, totally. And to go back with the power play, you know, Black Ice is expecting a shot from Turnbull there, you know, and Lauren just made a great read to get a shot on net because, you know, honestly, they weren't really expecting a Lauren Barron shot. They're expecting a Travis Turnbull shot. So it's a good read by him to get a puck to the net.
No, for sure. And here we're going to fast forward here the game a little bit. We're going to get to another power play. Another face-off here. Again, the topic of the day has been face-offs. So let's talk about this one here.
At Siebel, asking the refs what the situation is. I think they threw somebody off for a late change.
So, Greg, now once again, we're looking at this awkward power setup on the faceoff by Black Ice. Now, Mudcats are in the position before that you wish Black Ice were in, right? They got four across.
Yeah.
And they already point about who's going to get who off the draw. Black Ice has got two back, which I don't really understand it. You know, again, I know they're great on draws at times, but here, again, this area right here on the boards, if a neutral puck comes there, they're going to get the puck easily. They have numbers. And honestly, if I'm Larry Adigoke taking this draw, this is all I'm thinking right now. As long as I don't lose the draw clean back, we got the puck. Yeah. Now, if it's a neutral one, my guys are going to jump and get it for me. If I win it back to the corner, we got it. If I win it to the boards, we got it. No matter where this puck goes, except of a direct win back, and I'm a big, strong guy like Larry, and now I don't know if that's KJ taking the draw. I can't tell who it is. Maybe John Healy, I think, taking the draw. Yeah, it's John Healy. So, again, you got a lefty in an awkward spot here to me taking this faceoff. Me as a lefty, I really don't like taking a draw in this spot. And if I do, I definitely want a guy right here for me to win that puck back to. So let's see what happens on this draw.
Face-off win again for the Mudcat.
So there, Greg, easy win. I mean, Larry won it cleanly anyway. It didn't matter. But easy breakout then for the Mudcats and easy control of the puck.
Yep, totally. Time and time again, we talk about face-offs, Tim, and that's just another example.
I'm going to rewind here for a second, I'm trying to see if this was the play involving DiMartino. After that draw, let's rewind this play this through a little
face-off
bit.
Face-off win again for the Mudcats.
The Mudcats have won a lot of draws.
They have, and they recently. Do. They do well with face-offs.
DiMartino went on the floor.
Okay,
they've picked up the pace too.
They have. Cripps, that's a shot deflected. Especially with goal differential being so important, you wait a little.
It's not even crossed
it
your mind.
It might be 145, but with goal differential being the first tiebreak, it's about 120. Oh, they score! CJ Yoder!
We won't need to talk about it after all.
All right, Greg, I'll let you run through this one here. Great play by Humpbrinker.
Yeah, Humpbrinker makes a great play in the corner. Comes out. I like to see Kaz get a body, you know, get a piece, do something defensively there. But it looks like John Healy gets caught puck watching and lets his man CJ Yoder slide in for an easy goal there.
And watch Humpbrinker here, Greg, too. Like, he's technically almost 1-on-4 here. He just flips a puck and goes and gets it, right?
Yeah, a little ice hockey style there.
He goes and gets it. bad luck there. Man falls. And yeah, we talked about John Healy on this play. So John Healy is right about here, and he's got to read CJ breaking in here and doesn't. And that's where Humphrey makes a great play and finds him. And John Healy is a little late to the party there on that one. And they tie it up 3-3.
So that's a huge goal by the Mudcats there. And, you know, looks like Matt Gerger took a digger in the corner there, kind of took an awkward fall, which let Humpringer, you know, he won the battle, but Humpringer was easily just walked out of the corner. No one got a piece of him and made the easy play to CJ Yoder.
So the Goats got two goals that game. I guess that Fountain of Youth is doing them good, Greg.
Yeah, I'd say so.
I think we got to get one of those to Patchogue.
And Rockville Center.
All right, so watch this one here now. So,
I mean, depending on the situation.
Yes.
It's Gerger, Nate Gerger, check from behind.
So now KJ gives a shot to the back here.
Mm-hmm.
Knocks him down, and then he trips back.
Ooh.
And I know guys are going to boo the second one there. A lot of times you catch the second one, but really I think the refs here did a good job. They let them both get away with a penalty here and just let the boys play.
Bye. Frank.
Ooh.
Take him down.
That'll safe and worth.
Did my cats get away with one there?
They might have because the usher in the corner watching the game had his hand up.
2-on-1. Frank looking, tried to get it across. Great play by Piscotty to break it up. Two Mudcat players.
But
Piscotty gets it to Tiffinworth. Tiffinworth up on the wing. DiMartino, who was in the box the last time there was a goal scored. Coincidental penalties. There's a turnover. It's Kraft. Kraft in. Fires. That one's deflected wide. Comes up, and now it's going to be the Mudcats getting to the puck first. Cutting in. Here's a chance. Mudcats scores!
Oh, wow.
Ryan Gault makes it 4-3.
That's some goal there. A lot happened on this, Greg. So we're going to rewind here. And one thing, and I was right before. So before that last goal, PJ DiMartino, and I don't remember who it was. I think it was Sky Lahore on the Mudcats. They got into it behind the net.
Yeah.
And the refs gave him coincidentals.
Mm-hmm.
And the announcers had made a comment that that's a loss for the Black Ice because PJ is arguably their best all-around player. And when that goal was scored by CJ to tie it 3-3, PJ was in the box. So really, technically, every goal given up in this game for the Black Ice at this point, they've had men in the box. You know, there was two power play goals, and then PJ DiMartino on a coincidental. And if I'm Mudcats, you know, not that Sky Lahore is not a great player, but we got a lot of players. I take PJ off all day long. So that's, again, guys in the box for Black Ice. But here on this goal, Tyler Crafts gets a chance, and a rare mistake by Tyler Crafts. You know, he tries to shoot a little too much, puts a little too much behind it, misses the net, sends him on a breakout the other way. Now, granted, Black Ice still had numbers kind of, and it really wasn't like an odd man break for Mudcats. But Gault makes a tremendous play here, and Nate Gerger gets beat a little bit off the boards. And PJ DiMartino, who was back-checking, kind of let off a little bit knowing that Nate had him. And then Gault just makes a sick play and comes in and makes an amazing goal, probably the biggest goal of his PAMA Pro career here. So let's watch it full again.
Coincidental penalties. There's a turnover. It's Kraft.
See, here's Kraft here, Greg. Misses it wide.
In, fires. That one's deflected wide. Comes up, and now it's going to be the Mud.
So let's watch here this play by Gault, Greg. So you see PJ's on a little bit here, Greg, but you're okay, right, with PJ backing off a little bit here knowing he's got help, right?
Yeah, I do like PJ kind of following up the play just because Billy Piscotty there has the trailer as the second man for the Mudcats coming. So why not give him some more help? But, again, you know, Nate shouldn't have stepped up like that and gotten beat. He should have gotten a piece of the puck or a piece of the body.
And I love Nate's positioning here, Greg, where he's at. But if you notice, as the puck comes, he turns his body a little bit here, and now his butt's facing the far boards, where you want your butt more facing the net. If he's backed up a little bit here, more square to his goal, I don't think this puck ever gets through. But then again, a little bad luck. Gault got lucky. The puck bounced a little bit. Mm-hmm. But I just love the speed and the athleticism of Gault here. And the finish. Just a great goal. And the Mudcats go wild here. They got their first lead of the game with 3:44 left.
Yeah. I mean, going into the second period, Black Ice had all momentum, had the lead. Didn't think Mudcats really had a chance in this game after that period because of the puck possession and the play by Black Ice, but they really fought through and scored some timely goals.
Yeah, now we have a big play here, a big non-call. Cal Kafu comes up high with a high stick. You see Chad, I love Chad Siebel. He's one of my favorite characters in the game. You see him arms up on the bench and watching the replay here. I think the Mudcats were right. I think Cal got away with a high stick here on the ground here. Let's watch this one. And at the time, Dennis Jelcic doing the announcing was adamant that he missed. The refs made a good call there. But speaking to Dennis afterwards, I think he now watched the play. Says, oh, they got away with one.
Tim, before you play this, we did get a text from Sky Lahore. He said he knew what he was doing there. And he said, I'll take that trade all day. It's a little baiting. Laugh out loud.
All right, so that's the veteran right there. Sky Lahore, now he's taking P.J. DeMartino out of the game. He'll take that trade. So smart play by Sky Lahore. Again, like I said, one of my favorites in the game.
1-1, correct? Yeah. And both have 6 and 3 points?
Yeah.
Palmas win his regulation. Oh, here we go, 3:30 left.
Ooh. There, the stick to
– look at Chad Siebel there on the bench, Greg. Armed up. No, Chad loves to get up. But here, watch the play here. Let's watch it in slow-mo here a little bit. So you always have to control your stick, even if the man's down on his knees. So Cal here, puck comes up. It's obviously accidental, but it does catch him in the face here. And they got away with
there's
one there.
There's a stick to the face. No call there. I think he dragged it.
You know, Chad's mad when his mask comes off. He was fired up there. But, yeah, they got away with him. But it happens, right? It happens to all of us. So
yeah, the game.
The game continues.
No, He might have. That's a tough one. That's a tough one.
We'll see that later.
Yeah, if we can save that clip there. You're I do want to see that. If we could save that clip there.
You're not getting that.
All right, and so the game stays this score till the end of the game. Here, Greg, it's 4-3. Actually, Mudcats right now, our scorekeeper has not updated the video here, which annoys me to watch that. And let's fast forward here to a late faceoff here for Black Ice. All right, Greg, so here's the four across like you like it with the Mudcats. They're already talking about who's going to get out to the point. And what I like here about Black Ice is they're all in here. And you'll see the puck go forward. I love how Cal Kafuk, Billy Pascali, they work hard here. And they come away with this puck because, you know, they want to pull their goalie here, right? So there's a minute 12 left in the game. They're down by a goal. They choose not to pull it until the faceoff's won, which I agree with that call by Jay Muro. But Black Mudcats got to be thinking, we win this faceoff, which I've done a lot today. They can't pull their goalie, but Black Ice, I love the energy of a younger team here getting this puck.
Pascali against Huntington on the faceoff. Huntington.
Because Mudcats actually won that draw, Greg. Huntbrinker, I know George kept calling him Huntington. Huntbrinker wins that puck back. Let's watch it again here. Mudcats win this faceoff. Clean. Yeah.
Hold up there. So let me ask you something. I know it's tight over on the wall side, on the half wall, but you know, Billy's a righty there going to his backhand, trying to win the draw back to, I think, I'm not sure who's back there, but would it be cool to see maybe two guys lined up on the boards? I don't know if there's enough room over there, two guys in the Mudcats maybe, to make it easier to shoot out to him.
Yeah. I mean, I guess you want to protect your net there. You don't want to get caught too far from the net. I can see a shadow of a stick here. So the Black Ice player is definitely on the boards here.
Yeah.
So maybe could have got away with it.
Yeah. I don't know if there's enough room though for a guy to shoot out. You know, I don't know how tight it is over there. It looks kind of tight, but it's just something to think about in the future.
I mean, me personally, if I was setting up this faceoff here, what I would like to see is this extra Mudcat man here. And I know you're normally not a fan of this, but with this setup, and now Tyler Kraft's the one at the point here, I'd be okay with seeing this man down here.
Yeah.
To win that faceoff back to him.
Yeah.
Because he can't hurt you from here. He's not going to get out to him up there. So he's kind of useless up here to me if everyone covers their men. And you know you got a lefty taking this draw back. And if he's back here, and again, it's easy to say now, but Mudcats get this puck then if he's back there.
Yeah.
Let's play it through.
Huntington wins it.
But Cal makes a great play there.
Here we go.
And I love how Billy doesn't think twice. Off the boards. He knows Kraft's there. That's a pro play by Billy Pascali. Now Kraft has it.
Here we go.
And Black Ice can pull their goalie. KJ, I'm sure that is coming out.
Kraft,
and now they do their thing here, and we'll watch the last minute.
I don't know. I don't know if they do.
Well, okay.
Kraft. Pascali. Mascali tried to look back door. Dumped down. That's all the way down. It'll go wide, though.
Not icing.
Thanks. DiMartino will pick it up with 45 left. Kraft. Don't let him shoot if you're the Mudcats, and they didn't. Great block there. Huntington. Mascali wins that battle.
30 left.
DiMartino. DiMartino. Kafouk. DiMartino. Fed it. Oh, nearly tipped home. Pascali tries to wrap around, cleared it in front. DiMartino has it. DiMartino fakes a shot to the backhand. Still on the backhand. That's deflected in the corner.
I'm going to stop that there, Greg. Great play by PJ. I know we talked about this the other day. The only thing I'm not a fan of right here for Black Ice, after PJ makes this great play, is let's watch KJ and Cal Kafouk. You got two lefties here. Okay, Greg?
Yeah.
And they're basically on top of one another in the same position. So they're not helping each other at all. They're, if anything, they're in each other's way here. So I would love to have seen them coordinate a little bit better and maybe have a man up here a little higher, a man high, low, down on the lefty side here. But right here, to me, Cal and PJ aren't helping each other here by being on top of each other. And then PJ tries to force the puck over to him, and Mudcats make a great play here in desperation and stop him.
In the corner,
better shot there.
Good battling behind the net, but it's taken away by Black Ice. Tiffenworth to Kafouk between his legs. Kraft takes it with 10
seconds.
Kraft has it. Kraft, DiMartino. DiMartino fires, deflected out of play. 4 seconds left in.
Great play by Humbringer there to block that.
Yeah, it's a good stick.
Big addition to the Mudcats. Okay, last face off here. And so, Greg, while we roll, I'm going to let roll out here. So this is the first game maybe of the tournament that we had some shenanigans go on after the game. So we'll play it through, and then we'll talk about it here.
There you go.
Face off to the right of Clay Taylor. Mascali wins it forward. Mascali couldn't win.
Looked like Billy was winning that to himself there, Greg.
Yeah, he's maybe trying to get it to the
– you got 2 seconds here.
I don't know. It's kind of tough to see, but there's – 4 Mudcats in the way, so I don't think that's a smart play. Maybe he was trying to push into the centerman for, I think that's Kraft or, yeah, I think that's Kraft behind him, maybe for him to give him a lane.
Yeah, I think the only chance you have here, let's face it, 2 seconds, chance is slim to none. Yeah. Your only chance, I think even winning it back to someone might not be enough. I'd maybe have Cal Kafouk take this draw and just try to win one on net off the draw as a lefty there, but
yeah.
Billy kind of tipped it to himself.
Right, Clay Taylor. Mascali wins it forward. Mascali couldn't win it. Huntington takes it. And that's it.
So now we're going to watch here. So PJ DiMartino loses cool a little bit here. And it looks like, and it's not a vicious play, but he flips the puck towards the Mudcat bench, which causes a little hysteria. And great to see the captain, CJ Yoder, just really take offense to it here and go at it with PJ and kind of, according to CJ, he grabbed him knowing that there's some big boys on his team that could go after him. He said he was kind of helping him by grabbing him here. So let's watch it.
Wow.
Huntington and Kraft.
You can see PJ here with the puck right there. And flips it towards the goal. Player's coming off. And now CJ grabs him.
And Yoder takes one out.
Some action here.
That's Yoder and DiMartino started that.
Oh, but still going.
No, but I think Yoder's talking to DiMartino. That's the vet. Yoder and DiMartino, no, they break it up there. Something happened there, and Yoder was calm. The respect everyone has for CJ Yoder is incredible.
Bad penalties lead to this.
See, Yoder.
Now, I love Travis Turnbull here. We caught this yesterday. We got to get him on one day to talk about this. He does like this little dance at the end here, and I can't wait to bust his balls about it and ask what he was doing here. He was definitely mocking someone, but he's such an animated guy, Greg, to watch. And he's a big, strong guy. You know, his dad played in the NHL, big, strong man in the NHL back in the day where guys, you know, ate bullets in between halves and stuff. You know, he's a tough kid. He's thrown a lot of punches his day in his ice hockey career, but so talented. But here – Let's follow him right here. He's right here in the middle here. And let's watch him as he walks through, Greg, here. I love this little dance he does. Just really makes me laugh. And definitely something funny to me at the end of this hard fork game.
CJ Yoder was battling with.
Yeah, Greg does that little.
Yeah.
You know. But yeah, so great game here, Greg. And this is just a round robin. This is just day one. 4-3 Mudcats. And this is the second game that we've covered, Greg, where if you bet on the game in the beginning of the game, you had the winner easily, and we'd be wrong both times. You know, when I watched this game, rewatched this game to do this broadcast, I had totally forgot who won this game. And I don't go and look who won the game. I just want to watch it. Mm-hmm. And watching the beginning of the game, I thought for sure this was a Black Ice win, forgetting that Mudcats came back and won this one. So great game, great effort by both teams. Again, a game of tale of two halves, really. Black Ice dominated the first. Mudcats pretty much controlled the second. And just some bad penalties and bad decisions by Black Ice and some missed opportunities. And a man named Clay Taylor really were the difference in this one overall for me.
Yeah, totally. Black Ice had a bunch of chances to seal the deal early, you know, to go up maybe like 3, 4, or 5 goals. Clay stood in there and stood tall for the Mudcats, and he was the difference maker of the game.
Yeah, no, for sure. And it's funny, coming into this tournament, Greg, when you think Tour Mudcats, okay, I want you to tell me now, we hadn't even talked about this question beforehand. When you think of Tour Mudcats, who are the two names that come to your head immediately when you think of Tour Mudcats?
Brett Leggett and CJ Oder.
For me too. So Brett Leggett right there is not at this tournament. You know, Brett Leggett, Team Canada goalie, the stopper for the Mudcats for
20 years.
Yeah, he's been there forever. I think CJ, you know, was a young buck when he started playing with them. So he's been around forever with the Mudcats, arguably one of the best goalies in the world in the sport. And he couldn't come for obvious reasons. Borders closed. I'm sure the Mudcats tried to figure out every way they could sneak him in. And I heard they were going to ship a big container of skates and try to stick him in there and stuff. But without Leggett coming into this tournament, that was my question mark coming in. Can the Mudcats play at this high level without Brett Leggett? And I watched this game, and Clay Taylor answered the bell big time to me. Not to take anything away from Brett Leggett, but he couldn't have done any different. I mean, Clay Taylor was unreal in this game, and the Mudcats had to feel really great about the future in goaltending with their team, having a Brett and now a Clay Taylor. But he was, you know, unbelievable. Let's talk about our three stars of the game for this game, Greg.
Yeah, so Tim, you'll have to there you go. Yeah, so our three stars of the game, we have number one star, Clay Taylor. Tremendous effort in between the pipes. Definitely kept the Mudcats in there early and stood on his head. Second star of the game, CJ Oder. Two huge goals, you know, for the Mudcats. Did a little bit of everything for them. Scored some timely goals. He's number two star. And our number three star is Tyler Kraft, you know, who played outstanding as well, buried a couple goals, and just played so smart out there, you know. So our third star is Tyler Kraft.
Yeah, I mean, you think about it, use that word smarts, Greg, and I feel like that's always the word we go to when we talk about Tyler Kraft. And a big part, I'll be honest, you know, we've done a lot of talk on this broadcast about Team USA and how the PAMA Pro Division truly is like a camp for the USA team, you know, and us going back and watching these games as we're moving forward to 2021 and Team USA, we didn't have a team this year. This is what I'm doing now. This is the homework now, watching players and, you know, in the future, who we wanted to be on this team and who's smart. And Tyler Kraft, I know he was jokes around, says I don't like him, but he's one of the smartest players in the game, and that's why he's on Team USA. And this game, he did what he does. You know, he's not known as being the goal scorer. He scored two big goals. And we talk about dumb penalties and whatnot. He's the guy you're not worried about doing that. You know, he's not going to take a dumb penalty. He's not going to put his team in a bad spot. He's an ultimate professional, and he does it on both ends of the rink. And he easily, if Black Ice wins this game, he easily could be the number one star of this game. But he winds up being the third star in a loss, but a great effort by Crafty.
Yeah. I mean, you said it, Tim. I mean, time and time again, he's just plays a lot of big minutes, plays smart. And he plays it all situations, you know, PK, power play, end of the game, just very smart. You know, just want to also mention, you know, honorable mention, Nate Gerger, you know, just made some great defensive plays, great passes that game, stuff that people don't really notice. I thought he played really good and deserves a little credit there.
Oh, for sure. Let's hear from our friend Laura in a second here.
Hey, this is Laura Vejeranta, world champion from Team USA. Well, actually, five-time world champ, if anyone is counting. You are listening to the SWH podcast.
Yeah, so there we have it. Great game. PAMA Pro Playback number 2, Tor Mudcats versus Mission Black Ice. Awesome game all around. Can't speak enough about the hockey level. And again, we talked about it last week. You know, Black Ice had their full team pretty much at Tor's. Mudcats had a team there, not the same team. So guys are still trying to find their way a little bit. Haven't played as much hockey this year as they normally would have at this point. So credit to both of these teams for some awesome hockey. A game that definitely could have went either way. Some amazing talent. And you know, a player that really stuck out to me in this game too, Greg, is a newcomer, you know, Michael Humpriger from the Mudcats. I hadn't known who he was, heard a little bit about him beforehand. And you know how it is. We always hear about these ice guys that come over and how they're going to play and whatnot. He was a huge part of that game. You know, that play in the corner, he dumped the puck in, got the puck to CJ for that goal. Even though it wasn't really on purpose, that behind the play on the power play, got it back to Lauren Barron, wound up shooting in, really got an assist for that goal for that. And he seemed like he was I think he got the puck to Turnbull on the one power play goal. So he easily could have been a star of the game as well, was all over the place. And definitely I opened my eyes to his play today.
Yeah. Living in St. Louis, I never really heard his name before. I think he's more of an ice guy who just started playing roller kind of late, maybe dabbled here and there, but you know, being good friends with Travis Turnbull, I'm sure they had some ring time over at Queenie Park, and he got his wheels under him. But that Mudcat team got better and better throughout the tournament as they skated a little more, and just goes to show you how much a little practice with one another can get you. You know, because they had a slow start, a little sluggish start, but they got better and better, and got pretty far in the tournament.
And before we let everybody go here, let's do some birthday shout outs here, Greg. You know, we didn't get to do them last week. And I know the first one I mentioned, he's going to be really insulted if we don't mention him. Our roller hockey's version of Matt Zuccarello, Andrew Otto, from New Jersey, coach of the Ithaca Grizzlies pro team, big part of the Empire organization, big, big heart, great guy in the sport. He's done a lot for the game, and he continues to do a lot, and he's going to be a big part of the future of New Jersey roller hockey and with State Wars. So happy, I think it's his 40th birthday today, Andrew. You don't look a day over 39. Happy birthday to you. So happy birthday there. I saw it's an old-time referee, Joe Casey, Smoking Joe. Joe Casey, who was a big referee for us back in the day from Valley Stream. It's his birthday today.
He's
22 years old. Matt Mosley had a birthday yesterday. Team Michigan player on the 35 and over team and coach for, I think it was the 2010 team with his son's team there. Happy birthday to him.
It was also Dustin Roos' birthday today as well. Pittsburgh native, longtime roller hockey player, Team USA player, Dustin Roos.
And Jetta Rekloff yesterday. Jetta Rekloff, speaking of Team USA, you cannot mention Jetta, the number one women's goaltender in the world, Team USA. I don't know how many gold medals she's won, but she's up there with yourself, CJ Yoda, Laura Vejeranta. Jetta Rekloff was her birthday yesterday, so happy birthday to her. Our goalie, Rob Phelan from the Scorpions ice team, was his birthday yesterday, so happy birthday to him as well.
Also, birthday shout out for our boy from Spain, Edu.
Oh, is Edu's birthday?
It was Edu's birthday yesterday, 24 years old. He made his PAMA Pro debut in 2019 with the Shakers. But, great.
I'm a big fan of him.
I know. Team Spain player and awesome up-and-coming pro player.
That's awesome. And, yeah, and we got some – I'm going to run through some birthdays coming up over the next few days here. We got John Jastrzebowski, our referee from Winter Wars. Lynn Iannone, a good friend of ours from Georgia. Michael Rosmini, another referee and character from New Jersey. Paul Melton, Team Ontario player, his birthday, 48 years young. Kobe Downs, former Team California player, 96 birth year. Kobe's birthday, 24 years old, makes me feel old there. Marcus Pajaro, you talk about Team Spain. He's the one that brought Edu over, basically getting involved in the sport. Marcus, former sniper when he was a kid back in Spain, doing some good things. Had some teams in Spain in Fort Wayne 2 years ago. Happy birthday to him. I guess Otto's son, Anthony, his birthday's coming up. So
yeah, we also can't forget about Chris Lurch from Pennsylvania as well, Team Blue. Chris Lurch is going to play tomorrow as well.
You know, Mike Huchen, former sniper, Jessica Howard, Team Michigan goaltender, Steve Mundinger, senior, his birthday. Mike Baczynski, goaltender from Black Ice. We just watched right there, turning the big 3-0 coming up October 4th. Wow, he's getting old. And, you know, Luiz Konen, player, I think Brazil. And just the list goes on and on. A lot of birthdays coming up. So happy birthday to everybody having one today, yesterday, coming up. And always a pleasure being able to call you guys out for your birthday.
Yeah, happy birthday,
everyone. Coach of Mission Black Ice Hockey. When I'm not home counting my gold medals, I'm listening to the State Wars Hockey Podcast.
A lot of gold medals for that man to shine. He can spend hours doing that, GT.
Yes, he can. And, you know, well-deserved. Works hard at it.
Oh, he's one of the best in the game for sure. So, great podcast today. We covered a lot. We got to talk to our buddy Pete Penicky from Life Inside the Bubble. We'll wait, you know, in a year or two, if he gets let go from the NHL, we'll have him back on and we'll talk about all the dirt that went on in the bubble that he probably can't talk about now. So if one day he's not working for them, we'll get that podcast together. And hopefully when the dust settles, we'll get our good buddy Pat Maroon, two-time Stanley Cup champion, on here as well to talk about all he's accomplished and life in the bubble as a player, which I'm sure is much different aspect and experience than Pete had to deal with as someone there working and dealing with all the crap.
Yeah, totally. Well, that'd be exciting to get Pat on. You know, it'd be cool to see what, through his eyes, his perspective of how everything went down and his Stanley Cup championship.
Oh, for sure. And we want to thank all of our sponsors. I mentioned CarShield earlier. And let's bring on PJ Cavaglia, the voice of State Wars Hockey, to thank our sponsors. And we'll see everybody next week. Great job, GT.
Here.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is PJ Cavaglia, the voice of State Wars Hockey, and you are watching the SWH podcast brought to you by Glass Half Full Productions. Thank you to all of our amazing sponsors, Mission Bauer, Tour, Alkali, LaBeta, Rink Rat, Conix, Warrior, Monkey Sports, Yord Watches, Car Shield, Rocket Puck, Wraparound, and Top Shelf Targets. We look forward to seeing you all on the rink soon.